said earlier in the week, reached then to his reserves of greatness to produce a better result by two shots than 33 years ago when you were here. Just how do you do it?
I should have better scored 33 years ago.
Indeed, yeah.
Did I really? Well, I know I didn't play very well 33 years ago. I didn't play very well this week either. But you know, I was on the fringes of playing pretty well this week. I really hit the ball, or I felt like my swing was pretty good, and I felt like I had a chance to really do something good. But I just missed too many putts and three-putted too many times. I don't three-putt very much, and I three-putted, I don't know, half a dozen times or more this week, and which is a lot for me. And I drove the ball in the rough too often, and actually hitting pretty good drives, but ended up, you know, 2 yards in the rough, which I suppose a lot of other fellows have the same story. But when you're that close to hitting the ball well and that close to scoring, you know, you'd like to get a little bit more out of it. And certainly not totally disappointed with the week, but certainly am disappointed that I couldn't do a little bit better than I did.
We saw some emotion, as always, on 18, because we show you what happened there and, you know, what was going through your mind.
Well, you know, I walked up the last hole. You know, I don't know whether it's going to be my last hole playing in the U.S. Open or not going to be my last hole. I hope it isn't. I certainly feel the way I feel right now and the way I'm starting to play that I might play again. People have been awfully nice to me this week, it was like I was playing my last hole every hole as I walked around the golf course, and they couldn't have been nicer. So, you know, I just don't know. I really don't know. But it's USJ was very kind to invite me this year. I didn't expect it this year, and I don't know what'll happen in the future. But it's been a great run. I've had a lot of fun, and all good things must come to an end sometime, I suppose.
You give great heart to everyone out there in golf, and even Butch Harmon, he's thinking about the senior tour.
But No. Jack, I've had the opportunity to watch you play a lot of golf here the last few years, and I really feel this is the best I've seen you swing in a long time. You were telling us before you went on the air, it's the best you've felt physically in a while.
It really is, Butch. My hip has been not very good, but not that terrible. It's allowed me to play a little bit, but not. And I've been playing on one leg for about 3 or 4 years, and now, you know, I've been doing some things that, it feels good, and I'm able to get out of my own way. My problem is that I haven't played enough golf with it to trust it.
Well, you can see it in your swing. You're a lot more flexible. The exercises you've been doing have been wonderful. Tell us a little bit about the position these guys that are going off now. You've been in this position so many times. Last round of an Open Championship. This is your 41st Open Championship. What's going through the mind of a Tom Lehman, a gentleman who has won the British Open, then you have a Jeff Maggard who's never really won the whole bunch. What are they thinking about?
Well, I don't know what Maggard's thinking about. Jeff hasn't won, so I don't know what really runs through his mind, because you just don't know how that's going to be with a fellow who hasn't won. I haven't been in that position. Tom Lehman should be the favorite. He's leading the golf tournament. When I was in that position, what I would be going out is to try to start the last round and don't put myself in a position of losing the golf tournament. I'm not trying to distance myself. All I'm trying to do is let's get the ball and play the first couple of holes. Let's try to make pars. Let's try to give myself a chance for birdie. Let's get comfortable, get into the round, see what happens. Let the other guys make the mistakes, and let everybody else beat themselves, and then you just don't beat you just don't do that.
We got Montgomery hitting his second shot to the first hole, and that is a good start.
That's a pretty good start. Now he's behind. Now, you know, he's three shots behind going into the game.
Right. Sure.
And you know, Collins in a little different position. You know, he's been very close the last couple of years here in the Open. He's had a chance to win. He's lost in a playoff. He feels, I'm sure, that now he says, I'm in this position, I've got to make some birdies. Where Lehman is saying, let's put it in position to let the other fellows make a mistake. If they make some birdies, then I have still plenty of time if I don't kill myself on the first few holes.
How did you feel this course rated amongst all the 41 Open courses you've played?
Well, as a demanding golf course, it's probably as demanding a golf course, shot for shot, off the tee as I've ever seen. It didn't make a difference whether you played a 3, 4, or 5. If you didn't hit a good tee shot, you really struggled to make par in any hole. And I don't think, usually there's a breeder somewhere.
Yeah.
And there aren't any breeders in this golf course. This golf course is just relentless.
One last thing, Jack. You were combining two roles this week, professional world golfer and superstar and father. And I know it gave you, with your son Guy being here, he missed the cut, but it was an extra special week for you.
Well, I was very disappointed for Gary. Gary was really playing well coming into the Open, and he started. Gary is normally a very good driver of a golf ball, and I thought he would really do well here, and so did he. And he started driving the ball poorly, and I don't understand that he didn't understand it, but he knows that that's the thing in his game that he usually can depend on. His putter has been what he's been suspect of, and that wasn't his problem. So we'll see. I don't know. I think Gary's it's given him a lot of confidence. I enjoyed being able to play here with my son, and I think he's maybe it'll get him over the hump, and he'll start doing something.
Well, as you said yourself, you can't help but be a father, but you have to be a professional golfer yourself and get on with it.
Yeah,
thanks very much for doing that. It's always a privilege to be in the presence of greatness here on Sky, and we thank you very much. We'll look forward to seeing you next year. In the meantime, let's get back to the action with Ewan and Bruce. Thank you very much.
Thanks for doing that.
See you guys.
Lovely to hear from Jack Nicklaus, and well, Colin Montgomery having a smile and a chat there with our very own Kenny Brown on his way down the first, and a glorious second shot, it has to be said, for Montgomery. He looks relaxed. He looks confident, composed, and if he stays that way for the next 17 holes, he'll be a big threat to this man. Jack talking about his own game there. His coach is Jim Flick, and by strange coincidence, it's Jim who teaches Tom Lehman. Now, at the first, Ernie Els, we saw him pull his tee shot over into the left-hand rough, and from there, he's found the left-hand bunker. Splash shot out there, superb control, and that should be a four for Els, but Bruce Montgomery's looking for something better than that.
He is indeed. That of course recorded, and well, a very big putt, because if this goes in, confidence soars.
Monty is up and running, a three at the first, and he's closed the gap to just two shots. The perfect start.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the final pairing of the 97th United States Open Championship. From the Woodlands, Texas, Jeff Maggard. Play away, please.
Well, Jeff Maggard cast in the role of Steve Jones last year, and we all know what he did. But he is the unconsidered man in the last four, the only four who are under par at the beginning of the day. They like it. Three wood for Maggard, who leads the putting statistics this week.
There's his US Open scoring average, the third round the best, the final round has been the problem, that's the worst, 73.40. One of the gentlemen of the game, but when he gets himself onto the golf course, he's one of the toughest competitors. Sent hard and low down the right side, turning over from right to left, and both players in the final match have found the fairway, and we're underway in the fourth and final round of this 97th US Open Championship. Montgomery has made a move. He's now in there for a tie for second with Els and Maggard. Lehman has that two-shot lead. Back after these. In front of us, live on Sky Sports, the whole of the final round of the 97th US Open Championship. On their way down the first fairway, Jeff Maggard and Tom Lehman. Lehman with that two-shot advantage. And the good news for all of you back home is that Colin Montgomery has birdied the first. And that looks a little right at the second.
It is indeed, and a lot will depend on the lie. There have been a few plugged balls this week. Even if it is, though, of course, there's a lot of green to work with, but that's a an indifferent shot. We shall see.
First fairway, 159 yards to go, 7-iron for Maggot. Takes his arms in from the right, so the pin over on the left. And he's found it, left himself below the hole. Cracking shot from Maggot.
And that also, he's looking a touch right. Cost him a five yesterday. He was in the bunker that Montgomery's in, and he's found the edge of the green. Very difficult cross ridge putt.
The line Lehman should be starting the ball on. Just a 9-iron for his second. And that's two excellent opening approach shots from Maggot and Lehman. And about the putting prowess of Jeff Maggot, Tom Lehman leads the greens in regulation with 42 out of 54. Now that might not sound great, having missed 12 greens, but when you consider the difficulty of this golf course, if you miss one fairway, it's almost certain you're going to miss the green. Oh, crowds are building up, and a lovely sea of colour it is at 17 and 18. Thankfully all the storms and the cells, as they call them over here, have drifted away, and we've been blessed with sunshine and perfect scoring conditions. Ken Brown's at the second.
Slightly lackluster tee shot from Montgomery. Got about a 32-yard bunker shot ball, a little bit above his feet. Not plugged though, as Bruce said, one or two balls have inclined to plug in these bunkers, but the sand a little bit fluffy. Plenty of green to work with, and as the ball releases, it'll break quite a lot from right to left.
Well, under the circumstances, and day four in a major championship, early in the round, a very good effort. Chance of a three. And having holed one of that length or a little bit more at the first, he'll approach it with a fair amount of confidence. Difficult putt, this, Ken, of Ernie Els.
Yes, this is a very, very difficult putt. Just off the fringe, in the first part of it, the ball's going to really be thrown a long way to the left. So I would say there's probably at least 6 feet of right-to-left break on it. One thing I've always admired about Ernie's game, he has a wonderful touch, not only with his pitching, but his long putts. And I think that was the secret to his success back in 1994. He didn't leave himself too many 4- and 5-footer return putts. Well, Montgomery will have learnt a little bit from that putt. You can see the break on it.
Run it back to the first. Lehman to start with the three. Has he hit it? No, he hasn't. As Nicholas said, his job is to make par, and if birdies come, all well and good.
Jay Haas and Tommy Tools, we saw their lovely seconds to the first, they both birdied them. But Montgomery working now for a three here at the second.
A little bit back up the hill from the angle he's coming from, and just outside the right edge.
Superb start, and he's got the range early on. Vitally important.
Maggot will learn a little bit from Lehman. Heyman's putt, but he didn't put it to good use. Broke right across the face of the hole. So a pair of fours from the final group. No damage done, but an opportunity missed.
Well, just the sort of putt you really wouldn't fancy too much on the second hole, but it is back up the hill. A fraction again from the right, but not that much. I would certainly say not outside the hole.
Calm nerves from both Montgomery and Else. To Jeff Sluman. This is the par four, sixth. Oh, that's white. Tom Watson, the 18th former champion. He won at Pebble Beach in 1982. Finishing off with a nice tap in there from around 3.5 feet. Ooh, final round after consistent play on days 1, 2 and 3.
Well, if the first hole is as gentle an exercise as you can get, I think this is a very rough par three to come to so early in the round. 235 yards. 2 iron for Maggot. Started it right and it's not drawing back. Montgomery's bunker.
That's his top 10 finishes in the major championships. Quite impressive, but has never really been in the cauldron of the battle.
Three wood for Montgomery and absolute beauty right down the center of the fairway. Couldn't have placed in a better spot. A little bit left to center.
One iron for Lehman and he started it straight up the path. Wonderful shot. And, well, a touch of luck there. It hit a cushion of rough and has come back a couple of inches. We've seen one or two nestle right against that, so a little bit of, a small bit of luck there.
Pass putt for Tom Lehman at the second, and Maggot with sand trouble over on the right side. Montgomery in the middle of the third. It's the best possible start for the Scot, and the battle is warming up. Continuing live coverage on Sky Sports of this, the fourth and final round of the 97th US Open. Now, just some advance warning for you. At 11 o'clock, your time back there in Britain, that's in just under 3 hours' time, we'll be switching from Sky Sports 3 to Sky Sports 1. So just bear that in mind. Get carried away with the excitement here. Second, at the second of Maggot.
And a very good shot by Maggot as we go ahead to the third. Jay Haas for his second birdie of the day. He's done it, you know. 3-3-3. Playing in the group ahead of Montgomery and Else.
I mentioned that Jay Haas had a lesson from Butch Harmon last week, and well, maybe Butch will be gracious enough to tell us what the secret was there, because it's working beautifully and his score's coming down from day one to day two to day three, and he's made the perfect start to this final round. Now up there at 2 under par. It's a wonderful sight, it really is. Massive media coverage, and well, you can see why. Now that's the ball of Tom Lehman. You heard Bruce say that it just edged back off that collar, and it's a good break.
just see there some indication of the slopes, and with the speed of the greens as they are, you don't have to have much slope for it to become lightning fast. It's a downhill a bit left to right, and although he's come away from the cushion, he's still got to judge the putt ahead going through that fringe grass. Not easy.
Second of Colin Montgomery, 198 yards, 5 iron, and that's found the green just beside his playing partner there, Elnios. Long putts for threes, but greens in regulation is what it's all about.
I remember to save par, and these were the ones he's been knocking in. Shelling peas, 30 putts the first day, 24 putts in 18 holes the second, 25 putts yesterday.
Difficulty breathing up there. Americans promoing what they'll be watching next Saturday. New York versus Los Angeles, but we'll keep our concentration here at Congressional.
Not much between Ailes and Montgomery here. Not quite sure who it is to putt first, but both played very conservative shots, making sure you keep it below the hole vitally. Actually, if you go over the back of this green, it's virtually unstoppable. First to putt will be Ernie Els. Little tier he's got to go up. About halfway down the length of this 40-footer. But as I say, up the hill, and as it gets to the hole, it should break a fraction from right to left. Huge crowds out here, and I've just seen Ken Schofield wandering by, so he's obviously interested in to see how well Colin can do today. Be a big boost for our tour if the big man could win. Ken Schofield is the top man at the European Tour, of course. Been in charge now for, well, I think about 25 years or so, and done a wonderful job. Helped, of course, by his fine crop of players he's had.
Two iron that he's bent into a one iron this week as far as loft's concerned. Certain holes he's seen that shot, and others he's seen the big gun.
Well, he's had a bit of a problem mentally on this tee. He's missed his fairway all 4 days now, twice left and twice right, and it's cost him 2 fives, and he had a one putt four yesterday, so it really is a, in more senses than one, a bogey hole.
He may be quite fortunate though, because it just slipped into where the spectators were standing, and they will have trampled that thick rough down. We'll see.
Well, a good, very good putt there from Montgomery. Hole high. A couple of foot to cope with. Jay Huss. He's played the last 18 holes in 65 shots. He was three over at this stage yesterday. And now two under. Second of the fourth. Form horse of the last 24 hours.
Twelfth tee, Tiger Woods. No birdies today out in 38, dropped a shot at 10, and he's just come off a par at the 11th. And that's an excellent tee shot to the 12th. Again, this pin hidden away in the left-hand side. And unless you can move the ball in the air, you have to take it in over the traps.
Ernie Els seems he's done that more than anybody, having to hold clutch putts for pars just to stay in and around the lead.
Playing with Tiger Nick Faldo, who had that disastrous 7 at the 6th hole. And he's just come off a run of three fives at 9, 10 and 11. Started online. Two good shots there from Woods and Faldo. And President Bill Clinton is here at Congressional this afternoon. Of course, a keen golfer himself. Had an accident earlier in the year and had to have surgery on his knee, and has been taking short game lessons from Dave Peltz, who's the expert in the United States. Had one or two questions for Butch Harmon the other night at the White House. Lovely to see him here taking an interest in the golf.
Yes, and there with his daughter, Chelsea. And, well, what an upbringing she's had. She moves into her late teens. 8 years and the top address in the world.
$198 for Maggot, and this pin also hidden away, this time on the right hand side. Most of the players playing for the middle of the green and trying to cut the ball back towards it, but in the back of the mind keeping it on this side of the flag.
And that part of the last has given him some confidence and fancy his chances, and everybody else will fancy his chances of putting that in. So he does have the advantage of being not fancied at all.
Dreadful lie for Tom Lehman. No chance whatsoever of reaching from there. He's playing the ball up the fairway into a position that he feels comfortable to play his third. And you know, history being made all over the place here this week. Bruce, President Clinton, the first president to attend a US Open since President Harding back in 1921. Nice to see him here.
It is, and I think a bit of tradition, because so many presidents have been members of the Congressional Club here. Calvin Coolidge was in office and was a founder member, and Woodrow Wilson, and Harding himself was a member.
Tommy Tolles has dropped a shot, having birdied the first. He's back to even par. Billy Andrade had a couple over, and Jose Maria Olazabal is one under through 10. Stuart Sink one over after five holes of his fourth round, three over for the championship.
Well, here's the hole ahead for Colin Montgomery, 434 yards. No bunkers, you notice, down the fairway, but a big band of trees on the right-hand side of the fairway, which, if you're too right up against the edge, you then cuts you out from the green itself. And then, there's, of course, there's a couple of bunkers guarding the approaches. And those, in a sense, obscure your view of the pin Today it's cut over on the right-hand side, sorry, the left-hand side, pretty well where it was when this map was drawn. And of course the bunker on the left is the one that they've got to watch out for, because the pin's right behind that. There we go, say 434. And you can see what a big bank of trees those are on the right-hand side, almost sort of intimidating the view of the course. And really be over on the left-hand side as you turn, and that's a good place to be. And then as we come up, it's this bunker on the left-hand side that will occupy the eye, the mind's eye of the players, and actually playing this hole, the fourth hardest on the course. 47 pars, just 5 birdies and 21 bogeys and a bunch of others as well. So this one's got to be watched out for. Get through here with a par will do very nicely. Tiger Woods, like Faldo, still seeking his first birdie of the day. Faldo, of course, got one at the first hole. That was his last. Got it. Finally, he's got one. 15th of the week, so it's been a very strange round.
Chelsea having just graduated from high school, and Bill Clinton not too far away from us, about 20 yards away from our commentary position. And at the rate of 17. Third, at the third of Lehman. Up and over the bunker. Bit of spin now. It's downhill from there. And it's stuck. Oh, goodness, that's a fast putt from there.
Jay Haas for his third birdie of the day. Too much. It's at the fourth, and you can see how what a sharp slope there is around that pin.
Already at 17, the crowd gathering down the right-hand side there, and it's just a gorgeous day here in Maryland. One or two light fluffy clouds up there replaced the horrors of yesterday when we had a storm move in here, and we were told it was going to last 15 minutes. Well, it went on for the best part of an hour and a quarter. And then the ground staff rushed out and prepared the course, and unbelievably, it was ready for play just an hour and three quarters after the beginning of the storm. But no chance of that today. It's sunshine all the way. And of course, if we don't get a finish here this evening, it's not a sudden death playoff. We're all back tomorrow for an 18-hole playoff like we were at Oakmont 3 years ago.
Just one. What a costly hole this has been for Lehman. I'm glad to see the back of it. And of course, Maggot now with a putt that could enable him to join Lehman. Line just hit it too hard. 24 one putt greens. Master Maggot.
That shows you how quickly things can change under this type of pressure. Montgomery now, of course, just one behind. That's where we go now. And this is his second to the fourth. 6 iron from 174 yards. Oh, 2 feet further and he was tapping in for a 3. Now it all depends if that ball has plugged. And the president continues to watch all the monitors in there. NBC Sports on a break. These are our cameras covering Colin Montgomery, and down there beside them is Ken Brown.
Well, I have very sad news for Montgomery. His ball has plugged, but he is on a slight upslope, so all is not lost. But first to play Ernie Els, but I think both players getting caught out slightly by the breeze, and the second shot does play slightly uphill as well. Now, if you can keep this below the cup, he deserves a crackerjack pencil. With the bunker some 6 feet below the putting surface, almost impossible, so he left himself a very slick putt down the hill. And you can just see how Montgomery's ball is plugged, just half of it sticking out, but it's not too bad, actually, not too hard of a shot. Whenever you come out of this sort of situation, the ball tends to come out a little bit right, and obviously with no spin on it. Just got 5 yards of green to work with and be very keen to keep it short of the flag. Square the club face, play a little bit further back in the stance and beat down it.
Very well read by Ken Brown. He said it's inclined to come out right, and it did. And the good news, Ken, I suppose, is he's below the level, below the cup, isn't he?
Yes, and you can see the action there off the back foot and just digging down it. Pretty well played, and as you say, Bruce, vital. His putt is a good bit easier than Els, although Els is a bit shorter.
Three wood for Jeff Maggot at the fourth. Swinging over a bit from right to left. That's okay, first cut. Wrong side to come in from Phil.
Coming the end of his 1997 US Open, Phil Mickelson. 3 over for the day, second to 17. And that shows you don't stop on any of the banks here. Nearly a good shot, but an expensive finish.
Lehman with the iron again. Good solid strike right off the meat of the club.
This one is almost straight, maybe a fraction from the right. Easy to miss on the right.
What a save. Well, when you saw that ball plugged in the bank, you couldn't really see him getting down in two. But he's managed it.
First time in US Open history, the caddies have been allowed to wear shorts, and they've been determined to make a good showing and all look very smart.
There's the best finishes by Europeans in this US Open. Mark Roeder too well at Shinnecock a couple of years ago, tied 13th. But Montgomery's been carrying the flag for the best part of 5 years now.
Steel, a wonderful putt. As if that had missed the hole, it was going at least 5 feet by. And he gently lollops off for the next tee.
He's held some good putts over these first four holes, else he's had a few he could have missed.
He's held a few saving putts over the first 4 days, or all 4 days. It really has been, he hasn't been at the top of his form yet he's still in there. Fifth hole. James has in a lot of trouble. He's actually played three shots to here. So his fourth, and it's only a par four, 407 yards. One less than that, the information comes. But it's still not on the green, and he'll have to hold that for a par.
And this was his second shot. Pulled his tee shot to the left, plugged in the sand, and couldn't even get it back onto the fairway. He'll go back to the fourth, the second of Tom Lehman. Up a 6-iron, almost suffered the same fate as Montgomery. You heard Ken saying if you go behind this pin you have no chance at all, and that is a very awkward shot from there. Won't be able to hit the ball hard enough to guarantee the strike.
It'll have to go for the middle of the green, now attacking the pin from there, 5-iron in his hand, and getting the anticipated roll. That's all he could do, nicely done, but it's still a very tricky putt left.
David Ogren at plus one, tolls now even, one player on two under par, three players are tied for second, it's still Lehman at the top, but the gap is just one. Contenders for this championship, one of them who won the British Open at Royal Litherman St Anne's last year. He joined the major club. It took him a long time for his first victory at Muirfield Village. All 67s did the trick there. Lehman now an experienced player, but that couldn't be said of Jeff Maggott, although he does have Ryder Cup experience. And he's already won on the US PGA Tour. This young man, Ernie Els, at the age of 24, took this coveted title around the tough course of Oakmont in Pennsylvania. He's looking for his second. And the hopes of Great Britain rest on the broad shoulders of Colin Montgomery. His play has been excellent. If he can continue the way he's been from the start of this week, then surely Monty will join that exclusive club. Watch all the drama unfold live here on Sky Sports. But on Sky Sports 3 at present, we will be switching to Sky 1 at 11 o'clock, your time in Great Britain. So stay with us through to the end of what I'm sure will be a memorable championship.
There was that very difficult shot for Lehman at the fourth. Early on in the championship now, a little crisis for him. And as you saw, they're so difficult to judge the pace, but like as with Montgomery, he is below the hole, and that was his primary concern. Maggott would have been further away in two, and there's his putting statistics. Remember that two putts per hole equals 36. And so he's averaging nearly 10 solid single putts around at this precise moment. There's the ridge he's got to come up. And then it's going to turn pretty sharply from right to left, and it's a bit downhill. And he gets the other side of it. Very, very good putt, and straight in the middle of the hole. He joins Lehman in the lead. Astonishing putt, because it was never more than 6 inches away if it hadn't gone in.
And all that after missing a tiller on the last. An unlikely three it is, but Maggott now four under, and who knows, he could be the leader in a couple of minutes. Lehman has a tough putt left for a par.
Montgomery's grab, just far enough to be able to see the green, 177 yards, back into the breeze. 7-iron. What a height it is.
And too high, Ken. Bang on line, and just like the previous one, it's found the bunker.
And here at Congressional, we have a new leader. 3 for Maggots at the fourth, a 5 for Lehman. And it's birdies, bogeys and doubles, because Jay Haas has taken a 6 at the fifth hole. Remember, we saw his ball plugged in the left-hand bunker off the tee, couldn't reach the fairway. And from there, he found the front bunker. And the fifth hole's certainly been one of the easier, but again, only easy if you find the fairway.
Yards, an element of jumper coming out the rough, and beautifully controlled, a marvellous shot, lovely soft hand through the ball, and slowly gathering to the whole side, top quality.
There's 2 bogeys in a row for Tom Lehman, and he's assumed the role of challenger as opposed to challenged or chased.
One shot now covering the top 4 players. Tiger Woods deep in trouble at the 14th. Pulled his tee shot into some thick rough, trying to rip the club face through that thick grass. And from 193 yards, he's not only found the green, but he's left himself a putt of 2.5 feet for a birdie. He is capable of the most astonishing shots, but it hasn't been his week.
We look down, there is the fifth hole, tee at the top of the screens, green at the bottom, the solitary bunker, short right is where Montgomery has gone, and in a sense, well, we'll hear from Ken in a moment whether he's in the bunker, whether he's stuck on the bank, because if you pitch on the bank, you don't bounce back into sand, but if he's in the bunker, he's liable to be plugged coming in from that height. Now, Ken's had a look there, and perhaps he can, perhaps you can, Ken, you could tell us the fate of Monty's ball.
Well, I know it's got stuck in the bank somewhere, but I can't see it very easily. It's nestled down a little bit, and it's about 6 inches long, this rough, and they'd have much preferred it to be in the bunker.
Well, they found it as you wandered on. I suppose the only good thing to be said about this, he's on an upslope, he can hit it quite high, so it'll come out with not a lot of forward momentum. The difficulty of this green is it actually slopes from, it's one of the rare ones, it slopes a little bit from the front down towards the back, as well as from left to right. Ken, what's the secret of playing this one then?
Well, the best thing you need is a good portion of luck. He's going out with a pitching wedge because he's on the upslope, going to sort of stab down on the back of it. What tends to happen with this, the ball has a very fast shooting first bounce. And the green also slopes quite a long way from left to right, so there's a bit of luck involved, but if you've got plenty of green to work with, you can see how far to the left he has to aim.
It's come out very nicely. And he got the difficult bit right there, he got the distance. It's an unknown quantity coming from rough like that.
Them. Maggot with a driver. And it did, straight enough.
That's a terrific drive, it's right up the left side. You can see where the pin is up ahead of the green. He's got all that green to aim at the left. The ball will feed down the slope from there.
This got down the hill pretty fast and from left to right for any else. This is very much a lag, a dribbler putt. You can't afford to force this one.
Woods. Of course, Newton Cottage, the three woods, stopped very quickly. And he needs to find fairways and greens and get a few pars under his belt to settle him down.
Now, he's held a couple of good putts so far, but this really an important one. This would keep the momentum of everything going down the hill. Now, if he hits it firmly, which would be a brave one, he can almost take all the burrow out.
It's a fair display of recovery skills from Colin Montgomery. He knows just how important these last two holes have been.
Yes, and all the time he's building in his feeding his bank of confidence as he holds one after another. I mean, the patience to hit it so slowly. After that tremendous second shot, we're just a par for Woods.
Such a simple putting action, this one. And he holds those out with consummate ease.
They go down the hill to the sixth tee, the hardest hole in the course, 475 yards. Montgomery may be tempted to take the driver out, but probably long enough to reach the green with the mid iron. Surely hit a three wood, and you'll see just how fast this putt was at the fifth. Didn't want to leave his chip on that side of the hole, but steady hands, putted face looking at the hole, and a sigh of relief as that one drops in. He's had a nice mixture. He's made a good par at the second, two good putts at the third from long range, and up and down in two at four and five. That's what it's all about, hanging on in there. And then when you do hit a couple of good iron shots, take your chances.
I choked down, so I think that's probably a smart shot.
Voice of Andy Martinez.
Is that for the hole a little?
Yeah.
Hole a little because as we've seen it feed down. Seven iron. Natural right to left just sets it off. Right of the stick. Clears the straight and very, oh, he put it in. What a wonderful stroke. You can't see it, he may think it is in. What a shot from Lehman.
It's a very difficult one to follow. But Maggot's in prime position here. He'll want to land the ball on the number five, you see there, just left of the flag, and let it meander its way down the green. Just an easy 8-iron, shorter route, of course, up the left. And he did exactly that, and unlucky not to just bounce forward. Spin taking all the momentum off the ball. And Colin Montgomery has the driver out at the sixth. Having a look back from behind the green, that's the way it is from the air. Tee set back in the trees and all the water down there on the right. Very narrow entrance to the green and out of bounds all the way up the right. That's quite a long way to the right. Only one birdie today at this hole, and well, that's hardly surprising. There's the scoring average, 4.78, much nearer a par 5 than a par 4. As is the 17th, and so is the 466-yard 10th.
And just we didn't. He's pulled it up into the left-hand rough. He may have just gone far enough to the left to get into the air, trodden by the crowd. One thing about hitting the rough on this hole, it becomes a par five, so it isn't the end of the world.
Sadly, Kenry looked as though it hadn't quite gone that far, and he's in the thick green lush stuff. We go back to five, and the tap-in birdie for Lehman. Just making certain there's no mud on it, because even from that range, a lump could clear it. He'll repair his pitch mark afterwards, which you can see just this side of his ball. Four under once more.
Also with the driver at the sixth, and that's left too, I think, almost identical.
And of course, Maggot has yet another chance to take the lead. He's had a couple of one putt greens today. Monster at the last. Now had 31 one-putt greens in 60 holes. 58 holes.
Just how fast that putt was. Just set it in motion. Well, he didn't lose the lead for long.
No. Let's have another look at this shot of Tom Lehman's. Massive divots. Grass. Started it out to the right. Draw it back, as is his favourite shot. And down almost in the hole.
We're well underway now here in the final round at Congressional. We'll take a short break and we'll return to you in a couple of minutes. Stay there. Welcome back to this lovely picture of the majestic clubhouse here at Congressional. The players out there on the golf course facing probably the toughest test they've had for quite some time. And just a reminder that we will be switching channels at 11 o'clock your time back in Great Britain. We'll be moving from Sky 3 to Sky Sports 1 for the conclusion of this championship. To Tommy Tolles at the 6th.
Goes one under for the day. A 3 there. Only the second birdie all day. And, well, worth double that.
How good was the second shot to get it in between the water and the flag?
...132 yards, pin on 7, so 139, just 7 yards over the water. And a pretty sensible shot. This is an absolutely daunting hole. You've just got to leap the ball 5 or 6 yards right, or anything short, and you have a watery grave.
News of Jose Miralda Tharbel got it to 1 under for the day and 3 over for the championship, out in 33. But bogeys at 5, at 10 and 14 have slightly undone that. Got it a 2 over for the championship. Back on the tee. And really, if you've got the driver in the hand, you need a bit of a draw. Get it round the corner. Suits his shape. but overdone it, and he'll have to do what Montgomery has done.
The defending champion on the 18th tee, Steve Jones, who won in such grand style last year at Oakland Hills. Layman a feature there too, and what a lovely way to finish this championship. Maggot picks the tee up quickly, likes the look of that one, bounding its way down the middle of the fairway. Not a great day, it has to be said, for Steve Jones. He's 8 over par playing the last. Now from 86 yards, the third of Ernie Els. You see the ball of Montgomery on the green there. And Els going at it. No spin. Brave, courageous, and very well executed shot.
Billy Andrade, who had such a good run in rounds 2 and 3. Second shot at the 7th, the par 3. Not too far away. In fact, right in the middle. Even with the pressures of the final day of the US Open, some extraordinary shots can be played.
A welcome respite there at the 7th. It's been a horror start for Billy Andrade, who played such super golf over the last couple of days, but a 7 at the 6th has certainly halted his progress. That all happened a few moments ago. The tee shot on its way to the 7th of Tommy Tolles.
Hold it there, he's right on a ridge. No, gone. Montgomery, not surely can't hold another one. Asking a bit much, but as Ken was saying, a 5 here. Really no disgrace and no disaster.
Steve Jones at the last after that beautiful tee shot. And the putt not up to it. He had his moments of glory last year. A good third round of 69, followed by 10 shots more today. Already won in Phoenix this year. Sure, more tournament victories ahead of Steve Jones.
Well, this 6th hole has been the hardest hole all week and was never going to lose its position when they put the pin where it is today.
Bruce, you've almost seen a bit of a sense of humour at this pin position. The hole measures 470 odd yards and the pin just over the water. Well, Els, this for a par, almost dead straight.
You read it better than he did, Ken. He started it right, and in fact, it went right. So 5 for Els as well. So let both he and Montgomery drop back to 2 under. 2 behind Maggot and Layman, but of course, they've still got to finish this hole. Shot of Tommy Tolles, and you look at it short of that pin.
And Tolles very unlucky at the following hole, another good arm shot there. And no problems for the airship today. Came down very quickly yesterday when we got that weather warning. Spectators all the way down that right-hand side and virtually the whole length of the fairway on the left. And it's down on the left where Tom Layman is. Well, it depends what he wants to do with his third shot as to what club he'll choose. Probably leave himself a shot of around 95 yards. But with Maggot in the centre of the fairway, he is only one option. 13 balls in the water for the whole of the week, 9 of them today. Thank you.
one across the green and into the water. He was in the rough. I think Lehman is in the bunker, but the back of the bunker.
...181 yards up the hill. 6 iron for Montgomery. Got a lovely two here yesterday, and that should gather up to the whole side. The pin just 3 yards above the little ridge. Oh, that was perfect judgment of distance.
Should reply after the disappointment of the last. Tommy Tools managed to pile at 7, 2 putts from the lower level. And just as we thought, Brewster back out for Tom Lennon.
Yes, when you looked at Maggot's second shot, and that's a daunting task, I'm not certain that the best second, third shot they're playing here isn't something from about 80 or 90 yards short with their skills from that distance. I mean, they almost will get it closer than with a long putt from the back of the green.
Nice high fade required here for Ernie Els to carry it up the little ridge and get the ball to stop. No fraction left.
Thinking about moving back. Lehman wandering his way down the sixth fairway, and it's been most unlike him to miss as many fairways as he has. And that's what he's left himself, 120. Draws most of his short irons, may want to try and cut this a little bit and start it just left of the pin. And that's why he laid back so far, so he could hit a full shot and get plenty of spin and take the water out of play. Lengthy putt for a four. Rather more tranquil setting of the 17th and 18th. 17th in the middle centre left of your screen. See the damage done by yesterday's rain soften up the course and the spectator walkways, causing a brown scar across the emerald green fairways. All today playing just below 190 yards, but the pin set over on the left hand corner, and if two or three players should be tied or within a shot of the lead, well, just about anything could happen there, and it may just go down to that, the way it started.
Absolutely, shots can be gained and lost in seconds and several shots at a time, as we've seen. A very dangerous course, and more dangerous holes, particularly over the back nine. This is where Colin Montgomery is, 174 yards. Uphill all the way, looks more than uphill. It is more uphill than it looks on camera, and the pin today cut sort of over the left-hand side of that right-hand bunker. That's the previous hole, the sixth, 475 yards, and it's that big bunker on the left-hand side of it, which is the one that the players have got to go over. The very sharp slope at the front of the green back towards the tee. It's a little flatter where the pin is, but not by much.
Treacherous shot now for Maggot. This is downhill all the way, water beyond the flag. Firm contact on that, and it would have toppled over the brink and into the water.
First to go at seven. Very good to see uphill there, and then flattens out there, straight in the cup. Travelling, but it doesn't matter. 3 under par. A quiet achiever. I think he knew that was going 4 or 5 feet by, but it was bang in the middle.
Little down the hill, about an inch outside the right. 2 here yesterday.
2 today. Montgomery now just 1 behind. Maggot and Lehman, of course, could bogey the 6th. And if that's the case, we'd have a 4-way tie at the top.
Down, 1 to go. Well, effectively through 6. In all probability, there's going to be no change. All 4 of the leaders, or the last 4 players, making 5 there probably. And here's another look at Montgomery's putt. And I thought for a time it was going to stay up to the right, but then it turned and almost got out the left-hand edge. But that's his 4th excellent putt in 7 holes. He's held everything that could have been expected of him. More important, that could have been expected of him by himself.
Maggot to hang on to the lead. He's rushed that 2.5-3 feet by. But after the 6th hole, you come on to the easiest stretch of the golf course. 7, 8, and 9 have played pretty easy all week.
Drifting a little left, this one should hold on to the fairway.
Yes, that's fine. Ken Finn on 18 from the front today, 5 in from the right. So Montgomery in good shape there. Manages to get his 5. And 4 players and they're up there at the top. One of them is Ernie Els.
Quite a bit short of Montgomery, but bang in the middle of the fairway. The only par 4 under 400 yards, and there's the state of play.
Honestly, we're not biased on Sky Sports, but Montgomery's name has moved up from the middle of that page to the top, and alongside him, Els, Maggot and Lehman were in for one cracking finish. Seventh tee, Jeff Maggot, joint leader with Els, Montgomery and Lehman.
Is poor and he's tugged it left, but it's on the green and it's on the right level. Well, it was, but it ain't no more. And the ball obviously there close to the pin of Tom Lehman, and there's the shape of the green, the ridge.
Moment ago, Tom Lehman also 6 iron. Beautiful follow-through Lehman has. Highly educated hands. And he sends that right over the top of the flag. We're in for a battle royale, that's for sure. Because this man won't give up. His 2nd to the 8th.
Past the bend, and the slope is there. This could end up right beside the hole. And this was Ernie Els. Very good shot, because that is below the hole. Right to left.
16th. Ninth rather, David Ogren. Second, third shot. Just come off a birdie at 8. Every chance he might get one at 9. In fact, it's a certain 4. Stone dead. Bogey came at 3, 4 and 6. But that's going to be his third birdie of the front 9, and he'll get himself out in 35.
Another chance to see Montgomery's shot using the contours right into the fat of the green. And look at this spinning back down, and in a sense I'm surprised that didn't go even further. But that's how close he is, and with the way he's held out what I call the middle distance putt today, you'll fancy that.
Billy Andrade went too far with his second at 9, and that's the penalty he's paid. Got a 3 at 8 after that chip in at the 7. So battling back, plus 3, but struggling there for a 5. To the 16th.
Tiger Woods for a birdie at the 16th. And he gets another one. Only his second of the day. Well, you might have guessed he'd have someone worthwhile watching.
Of the two putts, I think Ernie Els is probably slightly easier. He's putting back up the hill, a little bit from right to left. This hole's been one of the easiest all week. Probably anyone, well, there's two of them, I think, averaging under par. It's a real pick-up chance.
And once again, the lead changes. But for how long?
Behind them, first of all, Jeff Maggott. Similar to the one that Els held before him, but he hasn't hit this one hard enough. Maybe a reflection of having bolted the putt on the last green 3 or 4 feet by.
Now there's a much more treacherous putt coming across the slope. Big swing from left to right, a little bit down the hill. I always thought these were the hardest type of putts. You've got to pull your putter head towards your body. The key, you've got to choose your line, and that sort of change as you're making the stroke. Just do it just inside left and firm, probably the putter's quick as it's just outside the hole.
They knew he'd missed it. Now Lehman to get a share of the lead at the 7th. He's trying, but he hasn't hit it. Rather like Montgomery's putt up ahead at 8, he just had to get that ball started. Ernie Els now the clear leader. A rule they have in America, the player can try the putt again as long as he doesn't hold up play. A rule that was changed back in Europe, I think, in the early 80s. Designed to speed up play.
One player this week has managed to reach this green in 2 in practice, John Daly, so very much a 3-shotter, just over 600 yards, but the key must find the fairway from the tee.
left-hand side, gathering up onto the fairway.
Well, Els may well have the dilemma of whether to go for it. It'll be something in excess of 250 yards and off a downslope.
This fairway slopes quite a lot from left to right. So it's easy for Montgomery's ball to drift into the right-hand rough. He's going to keep it quite tight down the left-hand side. Going with the three wood, it's a little bit easy to draw that. And just slightly overcooked it. Needs a good break.
And he's got it too. But a long way behind O'Neill, who's now the new leader. Well, finished a few moments ago was young Lee Westwood. We can hear from him now. He's with David.
Thanks, Ewan. Lee's just been catching up on some nutrition after a difficult day out there. But I should tell you that Lee today, and he looks to probably have a top 20 finish. He finished par, 30 par birdie. And he's going to get a nice prize going out of here, but if you wanted to go home with a bigger check, you could sell that handsomely.
Not for sale, though. That's... I'm keeping that one myself.
You must be very proud of your performance.
Yeah, it's been a good week. I've not held that many putts all week, but, you know, I've hit it close a lot and kept it on the fairway. You know, I was quite high up in the fairways and greens hit in regulation statistics, so... Yeah, I'm delighted with the week.
All round to you, it looks as if you're going to drift up the Ryder Cup standings by one place. And you know, to come here in your first US Open, up against the very best in the world, and no excuses for anyone. They've all been here, some have gone home early, some are still out there. And you've performed, you've always said that you were prepared to take on the best, and you know, it must make you feel as if everything you said is justified.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you've got to play the best in the world if you want to win the biggest tournaments and become the best, really. So, yeah, I've just got to keep plugging away in these big tournaments and try and make a name for myself.
I know you're very happy. He's been loading up on potato crisps and donuts and all kinds of sodas here, but on a diet. But anyway, you maybe load up on something stronger later on the flight home. But you know, we're watching there the pictures of the players in the final groups, and it's getting to that really tense place. And I know you had a spread bet this week. Explain that one.
Well, they reckon 3.5 is going to be the winning score, and I think it'll be, you know, 3.
If -3.5, is that what the spread was?
Yeah, there? Yeah.
So you've gone less than that?
I've gone less than that.
So he stands to win a lot of money if it comes in less than 3.5. So you're going to enjoy it. And what about the chances of players? We've watched a few shots, but what do you think now?
There are four great players up at the top of the leaderboard there. And I'd obviously like to see Monty win, being a European, but, you know, if Ernie wins or, you know, whoever wins will have to play really good golf. As long as they don't shoot any better than 300, I don't mind.
Well, look, Lee, you've given us great entertainment this week, and we're very proud of you, everyone in Britain, and we wish you all the best in the future. And Luke Harmon thinks you're a great prospect for the future, and he's been watching your point. So thanks a lot for coming up.
Thank
and,
you.
You know, you can stay as long as you want and watch this golf. In the meantime, we'll go back to the commentary box for Bruce and Ewan.
Thanks very much, David. Well, he'll need that check. He'll also need to win the bet because he's got a new Porsche being delivered tomorrow to his house. Well done, Lee Westwood. 371 and a 73. Now, Jose Maria Olazabal, news of him. He's 12th in the Ryder Cup standings at present. He's tied 16th out on the golf course. And if he stays that way, he could go to 10th in the European Ryder Cup standings. So good news, perhaps, for the Ryder Cup captain and fellow countryman, Severiano Ballesteros. Alden Woods coming to the last. We'll go out to the 8th hole, where Tom Lehman is about to play his second shot.
All right.
Finally, he's found a fairway. He's had three bogeys today, so it's been far from the ideal start.
Position. O'Neill, the four iron,
doesn't want to run out at the end of this fairway. Some thick old rough there, so Montgomery and Els in A1 shape.
This fairway taking a bit of a hammering. The player's laying up to a small area and plenty of divots there. Back to the 8th.
Yards for Maggot with a sand wedge, which is so fast the pin. He would like to, knowing that he'd get a bit of backspin, but he, rather like Els, has perhaps got the easier putt, almost directly uphill. And just that five of the six, the only mistake on his card.
An enormous drive from Tiger Woods down the 17th. And what a second shot. Well, that had a rounded toe, and it wouldn't surprise me if it was a wedge. 9.5 for a birdie. Go, he's got it, yes! And Haas back to 1-under, despite that double bogey at the 5th hole. And a third drive cost him a 6 there.
You've got to keep your eyes on Haas and Tommy Tolles. The others might all be looking at each other. They could sneak up and sneak past. There's a look down on the 9th and, well, a deep gully across which you hit your third shot to this 9th green. It's 607 yards, that whole hole. So it really is, it's two shots to where they are now, and then it's absolutely the spot-on distance for a pitching wedge for most of the players.
Scores in alphabetical order going through. Thomas Bjorn finished at 18 over par, total of 298. 13 over for Paul Broadhurst, who did extremely well to make the cut. He took 42 for the first 9 holes on Thursday, and he battled away. Paul Carter plus 20. He'll be back to try again, I'm sure.
Now both these players got exactly the same yardage, 128 yards to the pin. Pin cut on the back right portion of the green, little plateau there. If you get it right again, once again the ball will tend to gather to the hole side. And as Bruce said, they've just left themselves full pitching. It's very difficult here though to pick the wind. There's a sort of alley of trees. The wind tends to come into your face, and that's not necessarily where the wind is coming from. A lot of grass around. I think Colin Montgomery, if he is second to play, will be very keen just to see what club Ernie Hilton, how hard he hits it.
Behind them, Maggot for a 3 at 8. His putting boots back on again. Joins Els, 4 under. Many expected him to slide away, and possibly quite early in the round, not a bit of it.
Still got the same problem, the flag on the green hardly moving, but out here where the players are, there's definitely a bit of air movement from right to left.
Try and slide the club across the ball, get the ball running from heel to toe and impart that left to right spin. Now, has he overdone it? Oh, he has too, and that disappears from view.
That could be in an awful place. Pin over that side. Say, this is a harder putt. Sort of probably just outside the left lip. He judged it well. 4 under for Lehman as well.
3-way tie. And the leaderboard changing by the second. And Montgomery now 1 behind, but ahead at the 9th, he could do some damage there. He's in perfect position.
Montgomery seems fully settled here. Pitching wedge, ideal little shot for him. Just holding it into the breeze.
Another gorgeous iron shot from Montgomery. And Putt will move a little from left to right. And in a few seconds time, we could have four players at four under. The back nine's going to have the final say. Bob Sway at plus one through ten. And one under par and still not out of it, Jay Haas and Tommy Doles. A bit further down the list. A host of players there that are perhaps too far back now at one, two and three over. We'll be back in a minute. For Ernie Els at the ninth. Final group's now coming to the turn in this last round, and Els hasn't lost his position.
Just a fraction from left to right this one. I don't think outside the hole, back up the hill. Well, Els has been pretty deadly on the greens on this front nine, but this would be a real feather in his cap if he can knock this one in.
Well, maybe just dessert for a poor third, it must be said. Very difficult shot. He couldn't try any finesse, but it's a six at a hole that most are making four at, or will feel that if they don't make four, they've dropped a bit of a shot. What about Monty's putt, Ken?
Almost on the identical line to L, so he knows the break. A little bit nearer the hole, so this one's probably a fraction from right to left, but pretty straight and up the hill. And he's already had five single putts on the front line. This would be number six.
Beautifully struck. A four for Monty at the ninth, and he turns in 33.
For better than that. If you'd offered him that at the before he went out, he'd have walked straight to the 10th tee. That's a magnificent performance. The only mistake, if you can call it that, is the five at the sixth. Let's have another look.
Just see how close the putt was of Ernie Els. Half the ball disappearing into the hole, but it takes Els back to three under, and it means that Lehman, Maggot and Montgomery now lead the way. And then there were three. Sway still at plus one. Jay Haas and Tommy Tools, they could still do some damage if they make a fast start to the back nine. But you have to think it's between the top four. Whose nerve will hold strongest? Will it be Monty? Will it be Jeff Maggot? He's already had a couple of disasters. And so has Lehman, but they've all come through it. Well, in front of Colin Montgomery is the 10th, and this is how he sees the starting hole on the back nine.
A good drive down the middle sets up a very difficult second shot with the water on the right-hand side. And obviously you can't make it right. You've got a four iron in your hand, four or five iron in your hand, and hitting it left. But of course, left brings in the trouble of the rough and the bunker. So just a very strong opening hole to a very strong back nine.
Long walk from the ninth green to the 10th tee. Players have been routed through the clubhouse, past the swing and goal there, then down the hill
and the 10th in a little valley, and some applause for Montgomery there, and of course also for Elf.
Well, there's the 10th that Colin was telling us about. There's two bunkers on the right of the fairway. They are absolutely bang at the driving distance, and the fairway itself slopes from left to right as the players play it all the way up. It's uphill all the way from the second shot, and there you can see the big pond on the right-hand side that feeds a stream that runs all the way down the right-hand side, and the bunker he mentioned, of course, is the one biting into the left-hand side of the green. And the second hardest hole after the 10th, and no coincidence perhaps that they are the two holes that when the members play here are both played as par fives. They're actually off a slightly forward tee on both of those to bring them within the bounds of a par four. But look at that, just three birdies today, 25 bogeys, eight others, and the pin very close to that water up the right hand side, just on the front edge, and four from the pond, or four from the right hand edge. Well, when they're in the middle of the fairway, this is what they'll see. It's uphill, and there's the green, which slopes from back left-hand corner down to the bottom right. The pin today, look how close it is to the water over on the right-hand side. All these humps and hollows up the back won't really come into play. It's an awkward pin position because it's very close to the front, but more dangerous because it's close to the right-hand side. .466 yards. Same length as the 15th hole on the west course of Wentworth, but somewhat harder.
Coming to the turn, the final group, and Jeff Maggott and Tom Lehman in perfect position with their second, and this Maggott's third to the par five. Three-quarter nine iron, trying to cut it in from the left, and he's played a good one. Kept it below the hole, that's vitally important. Pitching wedge for Lehman, almost on the limit at 133. And because he hit it so hard, he got too much backspin.
Well, the story that all the scribes were after, a second leg in the hunt for the Grand Slam, is not going to happen for this year at least, and it's been a desultory day. But coming off two threes at 16 and 17, Tiger Woods adding a bit of class to the end of his round. This was his third consecutive birdie.
There'll be many more US Open Championships in front of Tiger Woods. A young man who's only 21 has captured the imagination of everyone. And as Bruce says, the Grand Slam out for this year.
Anxious look by Montgomery up the left-hand side, but it's all right. Freewood off the tee as we pull across. His bunker, he's left himself a very long second shot, but it's the angle to come in from. Well, I don't know, I don't think it makes a lot of difference.
is touched today by Lee Elder, former regular US Tour player, walking with Tiger Woods today. And not such a good day, I'm afraid, for Nick Faldo. From the moment he took seven at the sixth hole, it was a struggle. After making a promising start, Faldo finishing with a round of 76.
Elder's aiming up this left-hand side of the fairway, trying to hit a fade. Dangerous tee shot for him, very easy for him to double-cross. That's right down the centre of the fairway. Interesting thing about this hole, it's actually the easiest fairway to find on the golf course, and it's the second hardest hole, so it tells you how difficult the second shot is.
Back to the ninth green. Both players have a putt to go five under. But neither of them easy, neither of them as short as the one Montgomery holds.
Get in there!
Far away, but it isn't in.
Moments ago, Nick Faldo's par putt. And a full horseshoe. So it didn't quite happen, and Faldo started with a pair of threes, and well, it got progressively worse from there. Tiger making his way up the steps there, plenty of security guards. He wouldn't fancy his lifestyle, but he certainly would his golf game. A real rare talent. Shake hands with Coach Butch Harmon. They'll talk on the phone a little later on, I'm sure. And Tiger getting ready for Westchester.
Nine holes still to go. Tom Lehman has tapped in. Out in 36, one over par. Maggot now has a chance to take the lead on his own once more. Four to the turn, two birdies, one bogey, and all to play for.
Still no clue as to who's going to take the US Open Championship. Montgomery, Lehman and Maggot all at four under par. Scott Buchanan's hanging on well. He's plus two through 13. And Stuart Sink, who's just 24 years of age and maybe a star of the future. We'll come back with the last nine in a couple of minutes.
Welcome back to an incredible final round in the US Open Championship at Congressional. With us here, with Butch and with me, is now Tiger Woods. And Tiger, it's been an awesome week, as it always is with you. And it's nice to see you come in here without quite so much attention around you, and you're able to smile, because perhaps finally something's off your shoulder now, you can relax.
Yeah, today, not only today, but all week's been pretty tough. Requests on my time. And it's taken its toll. It's been hard to get the intensity that I really needed to have for US Open, but nonetheless, I still had time to prepare, and you know, it just didn't work out.
Well, you certainly gave us you gave everything you could, and of course the fans have enjoyed it today, including the president. We're looking at the pictures on the golf course now, mm-hmm. Obviously the players there, but you know, you can now sort of relax and play your golf, not in a different kind of way, but maybe with a different attitude now.
I wouldn't necessarily say a different attitude, because I'm still have the same fieryness that I've always had. But I'm pleased at the way I hit the ball this week, and unfortunately the putter just didn't show up, and that happens. And I've learned my lessons, some mental mistakes that I made this week, and hopefully that I'll rectify them and never make them again.
You'll be able to see some of the other players making, I'm sure, mental mistakes, all kinds of mistakes on the golf course.
It's nice to watch other people suffer, too.
Tiger, I know you had big expectations coming in here, and it really was more putting let you down more than anything all week, didn't it?
Yeah, I hit some good shots this week, and unfortunately I couldn't quite capitalize on those good shots, and when I did hit some bad shots, I didn't make any of those par putts, or three whacked it a lot.
Well, I think this is probably the most demanding course you've ever played when you think of the high rough out there. Yeah. Not taking anything away from how you played, but I think this is one of the most demanding opens I've ever seen. And we talked about it all week. It kind of took your strengths away from you. You couldn't hit your driver. There weren't four par fives, so it was a little difficult hitting iron off every tee.
Yeah, it was a little difficult that way, but then again, I don't mind hitting irons because my percentages go up, supposedly. When I hit irons off the tees, I can put them in the fairways, but this week has just been one of those weeks.
Well, we're watching Ernie Els there, and again, that 10th was a difficult hole. And early in the week, Butch used a word for this tournament. It's almost like war. They're looking at what's going on. It's so sapping, is it?
Yeah, it is like you're in combat out there, not only with the golf course, but with yourself. You're going to go through a variety of emotions. You're going to hit some good shots and get some bad bounces, get some bad breaks, and then get some good shots, and you have to capitalize on them. As you hear Tom's going in the back nine. He's gonna face some difficulties out there because the rough is very high and some of the pin locations are very, very tricky.
Well, Tom has had a little tough time on the front, especially at the start of his round, missing some fairways. It's a heck of a tournament going on right now with these guys tied at the top of the leader. I hate to even use the word playoff, but there's a distinct possibility there may be one.
Yep.
Tell us about the holes that have given you trouble all week on the back nine and what these guys can look forward to try and win this great championship.
Well, 10's obviously one of the hardest holes on the back nine, but the problem that I had all week was 13. I never parred it once and bogeyed all 4 days. So that was my nemesis. But as you can see with these guys here, they're going to face some difficulties. And it's, you know, be honest with you, I think Tom's in a great position just because he got off to that fast start and battled back. And I think that with that battling back, he's got some positive vibes going in the back nine.
Well, I think that's as good a tip as any from Tiger Woods. We don't want him to be nailed down to a choice of winner. But thanks very much for coming to see us, and all your time is precious.
No,
and you've had to manage it well. And we wish you the best in the weeks to, and now we'll look forward to seeing it work. And
you got it.
Thanks,
you
Tiger.
Got it. I'll see you there.
We'll go back to the live action with Bruce and Ewan.
10th tee, Jeff Maggot.
Well, Jeff Maggot giving no indication that the occasion's getting to him. I think he's got a very good man to be playing with. I'll tell you what, you're in quite a good break from Montgomery here.
A good break in the sense it didn't plug, but this is a fairly difficult shot.
Yes, it'll get your attention. Just 5 yards past the hole is the water. Nothing will stop it from going in there. Colin got a little bit frightened of it. There's a little ridge to go up there. It hasn't made it to the top. If it had, it would have gathered to the hole side. Got a little bit too much sand with that one.
Well, that's better than too little sand.
I think Ernie Els was fortunate. He had half a club short for his second because it was heading towards the right-hand corner of the green. And just off the front edge, Ken, a putter maybe a little chip and run with a pitching wedge?
Oh, I think he's going for a little bit of a chipper. The grain of the grass on the front of the fringe here is against him. And if you ever fancy chipping one in, this is the sort of one. It's right up the little channel between the two slopes. And up the hill as well. And Ernie's a pretty deadly chipper.
He is that. What a great little shot that was. It's all change again. We can't separate any of these players. And of course, if there is a playoff, it will be tomorrow. And that shot may be very important for Ernie Els. They're all important now, of course. Gorgeous looking shot, slipped the club under the ball, dived into the left half of the hole. And when I say playoff tomorrow, there's no sudden death in the US Open. It's an 18-hole playoff, and we had three players involved at Oakmont. And if that's the case, and we do have a playoff, we'll be on Sky Sports 3 at 4 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. The week could be a long way from over.
Could be a bit of absenteeism too in the offices in the country, I say. Or maybe going home after lunch. But that's all in the future. But I tell you what, it's turning into a wonderful day of golf. Everything it has.
A deathly hush around this 10th fairway, a tricky one for Montgomery. A little from left to right and down the hill.
That's the way to start home. That's the way to start home. That's as big as Philip for Montgomery is as the chip in for Els. That's terrific. A very interesting statistic there on the screen. He hasn't played the back nine anywhere near as well as the front nine, Montgomery. And another chance to see this putt. Almost putting down a ridge. Yeah. And bang in the middle. He has putted quite beautifully.
Off they go to the 415-yard 11th. Oh, back on the 10th fairway. Jeff Maggott sizing up his second shot.
Yards to go, a 3-iron in his hand, going a little bit too far left, and well, that's worse than being in the bunker. That's very difficult and very dangerous, rather like the one he had at the 6th.
Tom Lehman has to answer a few questions. Back at Shinnecock in 1995, he was 38 on the back nine. In 1996 at Oakland Hills, he also took 38. He came so close to winning them, and he'll need something better than that for sure today. Awkward lie here, ball a little below his feet. He's up the left hand side. 4-iron for Lehman. And looking at a gap in between the pin and the bunker on the left side. It's not a very big one.
Troubles there are around this hole, that's quite possibly his best shot of the day.
There have been plenty of them. Iron shot after iron shot at the flag. And steady nerves with the putter. So let's just take a couple of minutes out to have a review of what's happened so far in this fourth and final round. Feel it.
...415 yards, but doesn't really play that long. Second shot downhill, dogleg right to left. And just the little railer there. And then suddenly coming on for me, he's almost struggled all week. Ernie Els to play well, and certainly now playing the best of the week. For Montgomery, he knows he doesn't need great length there. He's hit a free wood all week, perhaps not 100% confident at this stage, fueled with adrenaline, and that's as far as his free wood would have gone.
Back at the 10th, Maggott's third. It's come out quite quick. Slow down, slow down. Good shot from there. Well, you wonder what's going to happen next.
Well, that's some four. As good in its way as Montgomery's before him, it really was. That was a tremendous save there. Keeps him at four under.
It all looks very peaceful from the camera at the commentary position, looking back at the clubhouse. And how many times have we said this in the last couple of hours? Lehman for the lead.
It had to fall from that side, but then, if you remember, Elsie's little chip was running the other way.
On 35 yards, pitching wedge from Montgomery. Beautifully done. This will gather up again.
Moments earlier, the second shot of Ernie Els down the hill, trying to swing it in from right to left and safely on the green. Well, Montgomery's made one or two changes to his game over the last few weeks. The man responsible for that is Dennis Pugh, and we can join him now. He's with David.
Thanks, Hugh, and you know, the changes and swing and all that are furthest from Dennis's mind at the moment. He's here, he's like, he's nervous as a kitten. He's been spilling soda down his shirt. He's so nervous. And Butch Harmon keeps reassuring him that he was the same with Tiger at the Masters. He's up at 4 in the morning and fretting over it. You've had a hell of a day, haven't you?
Yeah, we had to get up at 4:30. We had two holes to play, then back to bed, a couple of hours sleep, and then back to the warm-up again. So it's been a long day.
Now, obviously, we, you know, all Britain is urging Colin on, but we have a marvellous tournament championship on our hands here.
Certainly do, David. It's the sort of finish that you hope for at a major. Four players going head-to-head now. Back nine, and it's all to play for, yeah.
And you said, while we were watching the golf here, you said perhaps it comes down to who wants it most, and you certainly have no doubts about Colin in this, on that count.
Yeah, Colin really, obviously, he wants to lay this ghost that he can't win majors, and he really put his whole heart into it on Friday when he wasn't well, and he saved what could have been a disaster and made it playable on Friday.
Ken Brown mentioned his pairing with Ernie Els being a good one, and you echo that sentiment.
I think every player would like to play with Ernie Els in the final round of a major. He's such a nice swing, rhythm, pace, and then he's a good guy to play with, nice guy to play with.
Ken Brown's down with the group. Dennis, is there anything? You've left Colin there to come up here because obviously you can see everything here instead of being in the crowds. Anything that you'd like Ken to bring up to date with what's happened in the last couple of holes?
I'd like to know how Ken's seeing the way Colin's coping with it now, because when he's focused, he's not being pulled off by anything. And that's the key to Colin's performance today, staying focused, not getting uptight with the galleries, not getting uptight with the situation around him.
What do you make of that, Ken?
No, he's certainly not getting uptight. Just had a little word with him coming down the hole, and it was a little bit unfortunate his iron shot didn't go a fraction closer here on 11. Looked like the ball might spin back, but that putt on 10 was a real beauty. That's enough to keep the momentum anyone's round going.
Well, you can hear Ken, Dennis, but he's saying that everything's going along. The putt on 10 obviously settled him, and he couldn't really have done much better. But this is Ernie Els for birdie on 11. Well, it chipped in brilliant the last time, but...
Yeah, Ernie's playing steadily. Yeah, no fireworks yet, but he's certainly up there, isn't he? He's one of the ones we're worried about.
Back in the tee on 11, Tom Lehman. Perhaps, Dennis, what's encouraging to you is the fact that of all the top players, that Colin is the one who, in terms of numbers, is doing best in the day.
Yeah, he's moving forward today for sure. He's the great start, a birdie at the first, and the up and down at the second, making his par there was very important. Put him in the right frame of mind, and then a great recovery at four, getting up and down from the bunker.
So we see one co-leader back on the 11th tee, Jeff Maggart. Absolutely central. And of course, up ahead. We now have Colin trying to become leader on his own.
Yeah, this goes five under now.
Good range for Colin?
Good range. He's putted well. He's got a good feel for the greens now. Good stroke going on him today.
Oh, no. He knew that one was gone the minute it left the putter, but no damage. Ian Ernie can move out of that shortish par 4 11th as long as he can drift this one back in. And then it's on to 12, where he has good memories from yesterday.
That's right. He managed to get his tee shot in before the klaxon went and hit it in nice and close. Just wanted to watch him hole out here. Good. And then they stopped play for, I think it was for a couple of hours again, was it? An hour or two. So, yeah, he's got good memories about that part of the course.
Well, all of that is a memory now because he'll be locked into this situation. How's Collins, we talk about focus and concentration and patience. How is he in that area? Because he's such a nice guy that he sometimes is seen to be recognizing people around him, as indeed does this man, always so nice to people. But can they get into their own little zone quite easily?
They can, Colin can't. Colin's definitely the problem we're finding Colin is keeping him relaxed and keeping him in that good frame of mind. He does tend to get more bothered by things than we all would like. And my role this week is really just to keep him relaxed, keep him in that good mood that he bought from Slaley.
Well, as we go ahead to the 12th green, J.H. is still a factor in this golf tournament. This for birdie from a long way away.
It's a good putt.
Looks as if he'll stay one under, so you can stay with us as long as you like, Dennis. I know that it's a long walk on that golf course and you can see everything from here. You can stay with Butch Harmon and with me and follow it through. In the meantime, we'll go back and watch this live action and have it described for us by Bruce and Ewan, and of course on the golf course, Ken Brown. First, Ewan.
Thanks, David, and a chance missed for Colin there, but a difficult putt. It was quite sharply downhill and from the right. Dennis Pugh, a man who knows this game inside out, and the combination of he and Colin certainly working this week. Tommy Tolles dropped a shot at the 10th. Tolles, having turned in 34, picked up a par at the 11th, and that's a 3 there at 12, so he stays at even for the championship. Pin in, and Montgomery back on that tee. But before we go to the 12th tee, we'll visit the 11th fairway.
I think in some ways this is one of the easier pin positions. They've favoured the very back of this green, and of course there's a steep bank down if you go over it. They're more in the middle, more to the front. But of course, if you are past the pin, then it's a very dangerous putt down the slope. Seven iron for Lehman. Quite a short tee shot. Oh. Just when you think he might be buckling, he hits another wonderful shot in. Great second for 10, and an even better one there.
Yeah, those front left pins suit Tom Lehman. 12th here as well as on the left-hand side. And 196 yards. And a beautiful shot, just drawing into the flag there from Els. Isn't set up quite so kindly for Colin, though. He doesn't find the draw shot quite as easy as the fade.
He's gone over to tee up on the right-hand side. We'll go back to 11, the second of Maggot, 138 yards. And by using the driver off the tee, just the 9-iron. You have to marvel at the way these players can produce shot after shot of the very highest quality, and still there's nothing to separate them at the top of the leaderboard.
Very easy with this shot to overdraw it, and if you pull it left here, it's impossible to get down in two. Tee up tight to the right, so the people just to the right here slightly blocking his view. 7-iron for Montgomery.
Thank you.
little bit further back in the stance.
Looks pretty good from here. And not too dusty up this end, Ken, either. Could easily have been a little bit distracted there. He saw his eyes flickering to the edge of the tee and whether someone was going to move, but he managed to keep his concentration, and maybe not as close as else, but nonetheless pretty good.
So a flash of the scores there, four players at four under, and you can see again how somebody can just get that edge. There's two putts for a birdie there at 12, there's two shortish ones for birdies here at 11. I think Butch Harmon said something earlier in the programme that it's he who has the most desire will be the one who will walk off with this championship. But you look at Lehman, he's a tough and competitor. Montgomery's eyes look steely. He's kept wonderful control of himself all the way through the last round. And you know, we were focusing on a lot of the major players last year, and Steve Jones came in and surprised everyone. So we mustn't think that Maggot's not going to hang on to this position.
No, he certainly cast in the role. He was out in the last group with Tom Lehman last year, and I won't say unheard of, but not been a feature in golf because of his accident 3 or 4 years before. But I must say, he has been an absolute eye-opener today, Maggot. He's not shown this degree of resilience in the heat of battle in the past. And I think one of the great things for him this week, he's putted so well, and he's got the confidence that if he does miss a shot or two, he can still get out of it with a par at worst. I think it's nothing like having a great run with a putter to keep the rest of your game in shape.
This would give him his third birdie of the day. Cross the slope a little bit from right to left. Never really started it high enough. Gives Lehman the opportunity to take the lead once again. Putt on a similar line, a little shorter.
That's a result of Maggot having missed on the left. I think if he hadn't hit it as hard, it might have dropped.
They've given up the chances on the 11th, so that means, of course, that Elson Montgomery could move to the top. One of them can knock a putt in for a two. Struck this nicely. Putter face lovely and square there. Maybe the right line, just a little too hard.
Holdable effort this one for Montgomery from the right. It's a beautiful tee shot under the hole, give him a chance of having a run at it. And just slightly over borrowing.
You almost get the feeling you'd like all four of these players to be in the same group and play a nice four ball in for the title and for the real match play stuff it would be.
That's not beyond the bounds of possibility.
Would be tomorrow.
Some play off that, wouldn't it?
Well, this one a little bit from right to left as well, but easy to overborrow. Sort of two slopes affecting it. Just inside right is the line. It'd be very easy just to miss this on the high side on the right. Makes golf look so simple, we all wonder why we can't do it.
We have a new leader.
Two birdies and three holes after that six at the ninth. The perfect way to come back for the South African. Four birdies in the last six holes. Beautifully struck, but long, long way to go, though.
Six holes left for them, seven for the pair at the back.
Five players under par. And else with that one shot advantage. Welcome back to this fascinating championship, coming to you from the Congressional Country Club live on Sky Sports. We're into the back nine of 1997's second major, and it's proving to be a classic. 12th tee, Tom Lehman, one behind.
Good pin position. June was saying both these players, they like to draw the ball pin high, and perhaps a little disappointed that didn't move across more, but that's okay. Ahead to the 13th tee, Montgomery, three wood, and he hasn't hit this fairway yet, I don't think. Well, that's not too bad. It's all right in that stuff.
Very disciplined golf swing of Jeff Maggot. Holds his finish beautifully. And that's a gorgeous shot. Might just trickle back from there. It's trying. And it's still going. Oh, there's the 13th hole, 461 yards. And such a difficult tee shot because it's up and over the hill. Let's hear what Colin Montgomery thinks of it.
.461, members played at .480, par 5 for the members, par 4 for us, again thus meaning a very strong drive required, leaving yourself a 6-iron, 5-iron to a very sloping green indeed, probably the quickest from back to front on the course, and thus we must keep this ball below the hole. Anybody past the hole in two shots is a mistake from the fairway, and hopefully two putt and get off, because 13's a dangerous hole.
To an average, the 13th of just over 4.3. We'll get back to, in fact, we'll go to 13 now, the second of Monte.
He's obeyed his own rules, but there's that ridge we were talking about, and that's going to come back several yards back towards him. But he's underneath the hole.
5-iron second from Montgomery. He was just a yard under 200. So not a bad shot.
Regulation, and that was just trickled over the back. Unusual type of shot he tried to play there.
Well, you heard Colin Montgomery say if you go past this pin it's a mistake, and it could be a costly one for Els because that's buried itself in the tall grass.
Well, Maggot now with a shortish opportunity.
miles at five, but pretty quick. Momentarily, the hot putter has cooled down for Maggot. He's had three good chances in the last four holes and taken none of them. Putts that he's been knocking in with tremendous regularity, but it's still a par, he's still there. Still hitting the ball very well.
Well, we saw the second of Colin Montgomery with his five iron, and we can now have a look at what he faces for his third.
Well, he's in much better shape. It may be his putt before Else's chip. As he said, it's the fastest, the most sloping green from back down towards the front. You can see there's quite a pronounced ridge there. He's underneath that, but he's putting up the slope. Big slinging putt from right to left. And he's shown such wonderful touch with the putter today. He should have no real trouble in getting down in two.
Not so for Ernie Else. I'm not sure he can stop the ball coming out of that stuff. See where his ball pitched. Else was pretty close to the hole, but as Ken said, a low flight just curtailed the follow-through, kept himself over the ball and drove it in a little too low. Lehman tidies up at the 12th.
Yes, I would agree with you. I don't think he can stop the ball. There is one way, of course.
The only way to hit the flag. But Montgomery on the green, but it will be him to putt first.
Almost straight back up the hill. A little bit of a tear to come up. But actually, a relatively easy long putt. It must be some 40 feet, 45 feet. Not much break, maybe a little bit from right to left as it dies. Not a putt there you want to knock a yard or so past. It's a very difficult return.
The two he missed were at 3 and 4, two fairways that is, so they were a long time ago and a fading memory. Bang down the middle.
Camera that's suspended over the 13th, and you'll see that arch left wrist there, and then the drive of the legs and the head coming back a little just as he releases the club head through. Again, it's such a stiff examination. The second shot was good.
Yes, here's another look at it. And as you say, so nearly that, just failing to get out of that rough. And that was what he was trying to do. Minimum amount of way on it as it came through the first rough. Now he's got, well, again, he's got the same problem. He can control it a little bit more, but, well, the sharpness of the slope is actually, it's, as you can see there, it's buried as much as it can be in the short rough.
He might just blade the sand wedge here. All sitting down a little.
Oh, it hasn't finished yet. Very nicely played, but at least one shot gone.
Hello.
It's the leading edge of the sand wedge hitting the equator of the ball. Playing it like a putt, hasn't lost his turn. watch this in, four players will be at four under.
The hole.
Just a reminder that at 11 p.m, that's in around what, half an hour's time back in Great Britain, we'll be switching from Sky Sports 3 to Sky Sports 1 for the conclusion here from Congressional. That's, I think, 31 minutes time if my watch is correct.
Montgomery, not dead, but he's missed it on the correct side. He's left himself, if anything, a right to left putt, which I mean, can bring to him. Nice four, he'll be happy to get away with that. He thinks it's a very tough hole.
Well, I think the one thing in Montgomery's favour at the moment is he looks tremendously comfortable with the putter, and it usually comes down to that. But as we leave you for a couple of minutes here from the Congressional Country Club, no tournament can beat the rarefied atmosphere of day four of a major championship, and the 97th US Open is becoming one of the greatest ever. Four players share the lead here at Congressional, our very own Colin Montgomery, one of them. Ernie Els, tee shot, down the 14th.
He's pushed it, and in one of the bunkers, and well, that's okay. He's got a shot of about 180 yards to go to the green, but he can get there from that. Behind them, Tom Lehman, second to 13. I like it, it's online, but it's a club short.
The bank beyond 17, filling up by the minute. Now Montgomery's tee shot at 14, sending that down the right centre. And back she comes with a draw, slap bang in the middle of the fairway.
A little bit to his right. That was before Tom Lehman, and both he and Lehman in much the same place. Now, there are four bunkers on the right-hand side. Everything's points over there. It's almost a little bit of a dog leg, and Lehman Els is in one of them, but it won't matter. But then the second shot is sharply uphill to a green, as you only see the top two-thirds of the pin today cut over those three bunkers on the right-hand side. So if you're going for the pin, and it's only four in from the right-hand side, you've got to be absolutely sure of the club in your hand.
439 yards. Let's hear the thoughts of Colin Montgomery.
14 again, a strong par four of something around about 440. I hit a 3-wood off the tee because I tend to draw my 3-wood more than I do my driver, and the danger is leaking the drive to the right, leaving yourself 7-iron, 6-iron up the hill, playing a lot longer than people might think, and you might see a lot of people short there. I take half a club or even one club more to make sure I'm up there, because leaving it short is very, very dangerous.
That's how this hole has played today. It's yielded 11 birdies. It's the seventh toughest hole. It's playing a little bit easier than that over the 4 days. But it's not caused a tremendous amount of trouble. Only just one double bogey, but, well, still only the one hole out on the course this week playing below its par, and that's the eighth.
Just refrains from going in that back bunker. 202 yards, a beautifully played shot out of the bunker there. A tough old putt, but he'll be delighted where he's finished.
Well, lucky in the sense that's rolled back. It's made the putt easier. It would have been almost impossible if it had stayed by that fringe. Lehman first to go at 13. he's left himself Else's putt. Good sound play underneath the hole.
Pin right at the back of this green on the right hand side. 181 yards from Montgomery, going with a 6-iron.
Well, that's the first wild shot Montgomery's hit in a long time. Over by the cameraman. The camera will be moved down the leads. And Montgomery not with much green between the fringe and the flag.
No, that'll be, it's impossible, but very, very difficult. Oh, and a bit of a go at it, and now he's got the one you don't want back, downhill left to right.
A 6-iron for Colin Montgomery, and there's the target there, and you can see that his body line, his knees and his feet are all to the left, so that's what he has in his mind there. Off he goes, club on the outside, that's the way he set himself up, and you would expect it to aim just a little bit left of the target there, but it's here he drops it back on the inside, and now the club face is looking at the target. With the fade in his mind, it goes off online, and then as it loses its pace at the top of its flight, it turned over from left to right, and he's found an extremely awkward spot off the right-hand side of that green.
Left lip. And quick. We're into that phase of this championship, but gosh, look how far it's gone by. He who makes the fewest mistakes from here on in will win. I don't think you'll see too many birdies.
4 under's the mark, isn't it?
Yes. I think you might say that any of these would take that and pick the ball up and walk straight in and wait for the others.
Well, Montgomery just moving the gallery, and quite rightly so, and they're far too close there to play. And when you see a player with hands on knees staring down at the ball, you know it's not lying too well. He's just making sure he's identified it correctly. Test the left for Lehman at the hole before.
Have been the longest putt in the world, but the way he knocked that bang in the middle will have helped.
Ball settled down into the rough. Montgomery down the shaft. A little unfortunate with the first bounce, but not a bad effort from there.
Eventually gets his 5, but now back to 3 under par.
What won't be that obvious on the screen is a big hog's back between him and the hole. So the way the ball rolled back on his second shot, he's got to go up and over that. They've got to swing from left to right. He's got the advantage though, at the hole it's a little bit uphill. You can see he's aiming almost off the left edge of the green. It'll swing viciously to the right. Anything in the dustbin lid's a beauty.
Yeah.
It's getting more and more difficult out there. Nerves play such a big part. Big putts for Elson Montgomery here.
And of course the last group has still got to play this hole. And of course with no sort of dramatic things happening on the course, the gallery's gone quiet as well. Birdies on this hole. Lehman.
Fabulous putt from Els. As the pressure increases, Els seems to walk slower. He's got a slow heartbeat. Nothing too much bothers him. But what a second putt that was. Still quite a lot of swing on it. Beautifully judged right in the centre of the cup. Monty needs to do exactly the same.
Yes, and considering his considering he dropped one at the previous hole, a lot of pressure on that putt. A lot of pressure on this one. Feel like a birdie. What a great escape from where he was. I thought he was dead and buried over on the right there.
He just hasn't hit many loose shots, and he left himself in such a dreadful position there. But Montgomery makes his four, Els makes his four, and Lehman's had a good break. He's just in the semi-rough at the 14th. It's definitely a question of stay where you are.
It may only be a three wood, but it's a really long one. And of course, no question now of these players taking the drive and trying to get home into three wood for Montgomery as well. Two almost identical shots.
180 yards to go. And just a 7-iron for Maggot, expecting it to fly, and it has done. But he's just lost the touch on the greens at present.
Yes, he's had an inspired week. He's not in the top 10 of putting players on tour, so it's maybe it's a rare week which has coincided with a major championship. A little further on. And there's a view. See, that's, when you look down, you see just how close that pin is to the back of the green. And again, rather like at 13, if you go past the hole. Really no way of stopping it by hitting that pin.
Par 4, 16th is exactly the same, so they'll face another shot like this before the round's out. Then on the back of 17, it's on the very front of 18. It really does ask the most sternest of questions.
Not in sand, and that's an awful place, and he knows it without even seeing it. That's even worse than Montgomery's, because the green, as we saw with Els's putt, swings, is right downhill from the edge of the putting surface.
Here's the 15th, 583 yards. Again, the bunker's placed for the drive, but it's a pretty wide target at this stage, 3 wood, and it's slightly uphill at that point. Then the players will take a club that will leave them just short of any of those bunkers up by the green. That will give them something like a 95, 100-yard pitch in, maybe a little less, and the green itself very sloping today. The pin is over on the left-hand side, so they'll want to be on the right-hand side of the fairway, quite close to the first of those four bunkers.
Let's hear Colin Montgomery's thoughts on this one.
15 is one of these holes where only, say, 10% of the field could reach 5% possibly. And even bother. I don't even bother with it. It's 585 yards long, and I don't even bother going for it. I hear 3 wood off the tee, making sure I'm on the fairway. 3 iron laying up of the right-hand bunker, short of the green, leaving myself hopefully 195 yards, which is my favoured shot for a sand wedge.
So the pin not far from where it was when we flew over. It's on the easiest side of the holes. It's had 10 birdies, not surprising, coming in with a short number, but 18 bogeys and a couple of others, so it has claimed its victims, and playing yet again above its par of 5, very rare on par 5s, week in, week out in professional tournament golf, but it is a very tough examination. As you say, the pin 21 on, 4 from the left-hand side, so even from this part of the fairway, that's what you're going to see, a big bunker up the left-hand side, which is protecting the pin. And the green, as seemingly with most of the holes here, sharply sloping from back down towards the front, a waterfall effect, many different levels, and just a little shelf over on the left-hand side where the pin is cut. So if you're not, if you don't hit your pitching wedge in close to the pin, the likelihood is you'll be rolling away from the hole once the ball loses its forward momentum.
A lovely picture of Washington DC. Magnificent town it is too, great people, friendly. And it certainly hosted a great championship here. Not over yet. Just can't see any of the ball down there, it's gone right down to the roots. Words of Andy Martinez, his caddy there. Caddy for Johnny Miller from 1972 to 1982, but not for his open victory in 73. They used club caddies that year.
And almost wherever he pitched that on the green, the result would have been the same, because pitch it shorter than that, the slope is sharper. So Maggot one behind the leaders. Lehman with a putt to stay with a share of the lead. Maggot, of course, could rejoin them if he popped this one in. Fours and a five here in previous rounds. Weight that would have fallen in a good putt, but he'll remain one adrift.
Fascinating the way this is coming to the close, because Els and Montgomery are up ahead. They're going to finish before Maggot and Lehman. They'll know their fate on the 18th, whereas Montgomery and Els won't.
Just left.
15 yards, 112 for Montgomery. Neat but not really. Got the distance right in the jaws of the hole, and Lehman joins Maggot at 3 under. A little bit of separation, and all four players now on the last four holes. Lehman's 2 under for them this week, Jeff Maggot's 2 over, Ernie Els at 1 under, and Montgomery 2 over.
Well, one has to think, as they get close to the final two holes, that 17th with its evil pin position set out in the, seemingly in the middle of the lake, is going to play a significant, if not deciding, role in the outcome of this championship. The Washington Monument there in the distance.
Looking beautiful too in the evening sunshine. It's 5-6 here stateside, and still we can't separate the four players at the top. Montgomery in it.
A little bit up the hill and from left to right, this putt. Very slight movement from left to right.
And Lehman in the fairway. Hasn't had the lead on his own since very early in the second round. Bit weak, but near enough, hopefully, for a 5. Five for Montgomery, he stays at 4 under.
So Colin Montgomery still tied at 4 under with Ernie Els, 1 ahead of Jeff Maggot and Tom Lehman at this moment. So we're going to on Sky Sports 1 now, and all the way to the finish of a pulsating final day in the 97th Open Championship in America. We can check the leaderboard before going back to the play. Still that tie at the top between Colin Montgomery and Ernie Els, and it really looks to be down to the final four now. Two groups, and we're going to go all the way, and who knows, there could be an 18-hole playoff tomorrow. We'll soon see as we get back to join in the commentary box, Bruce Critchley and Ewan Murray.
Four players. Four players still in with a chance of getting their hands on that majestic trophy. Tom Lehman, the Open champion, success for him last July at Royal Lytham and St Anne's. Jack Maggott, an unlikely contender, but he's hanging on in there, still at 3 under par. Somehow he has to find a couple of birdies in the last four holes. Ernie Els knows what it's all about, winning US Open. Success for him at Oakmont in 108 degree heat. He beat Montgomery and Roberts in a playoff. Montgomery's back for more. After a 65 on day one, he stuttered on day two with a 76. But his grit and determination has kept him in there as he looks for his first major championship. He may just be moments away. We'll see live here on Sky Sports.
Three to play. Par, two par fours and a par three. And the iron down the fairway. Anything to get it on the cut and prepared. Iron two for Els. These two have edged ahead of the last pair by a single shot. No change.
Jeff Maggott back at the par 5 15th. Tee shot found the fairway and he's laid that up to around 85, 90 yards from the pin.
Off tape, the shorter of the two tee shots. That's nicely done up over the brow of the hill. Stay out of the rough, it has. That's position A.
Ken Brown's following the action in the penultimate match and is casting his eyes over the second of Ernie Els here.
204 yards, six iron.
Pretty good shot just left of the flag.
The president must be somewhere around out here because we've been all asked to walk down the left-hand side of the fairway on this hole, so he's out watching the golf. I couldn't tell you where because there's 30,000 other people doing it.
Maggott behind. Third shot. Oh, and a little bit short, and that's going to wander well away. That's not where birdies come from.
He left himself a long, long way back there. Plus 126 yards, forward to 16.
196 yards from Montgomery, it sets up quite nicely for him. Pin back right.
Brave shot from Montgomery. He'll have a big swing on that putt through from left to right.
Number seven.
Yep.
Comes the old LP. That's back there. That's back there. That's stone dead. Wonderful shot from Lehman. And you have that to rejoin Montgomery and Els. Brave, brave shot because it's only a few paces over the back of the green and no chance of getting down in two.
Beautifully struck shot from Lehman. Ball first, then the turf, and he was crying, get there, get there. And then get down. He didn't have any idea, I think, when the ball was at its flight, what distance it was, but he knew it was right at the hole, and he got everything right there. Superb third shot from Tom Lehman. All two under for these last four holes this week. He's made the perfect start to them again today. Face beautiful square there, shouting at the ball, and the gallery's reaction told him what the result of it was. Incredible drama.
guess, just as you were thinking that he was beginning to maybe slip out of it. Back he comes and rejoins those, and of course there is this extraordinary thing that he'll know what he has to do. Montgomery and Els will have to make the best of their way home and hope it's good enough.
Mental games out there now. Montgomery and Els would have heard the cheers back at the 15th. They won't know what it's all about.
Els has left himself, I would say, one of the slowest putts on the golf course, exactly what he would have been after. Up the hill and a little bit from right to left. They certainly heard the big cheer, but they obviously have no idea what it was for. Probably don't really care at this stage either. Just putting across the shadows, always difficult to pick your line going from shade then into sunlight and the cup itself in shade.
Split screen, bottom right, Maggot for his four at 15. A little short of pace. Top left, Els for his three at 16.
Huge swing from left to right, and very easy for it to get away from him.
Maggot taps in at 15 and remains at 3 under par.
The other two.
NBC first.
Now this has got an enormous swing from left to right. This one, it will die sideways. Pretty good effort from there. It's one of those ones, if you give any sort of a run of the hole, you'll knock it 4.5 feet past.
Choosing to go on, I think he's probably closer than Els. He'd rather get his putt in first. She's done. Good four.
Left for them, the 17th and the 18th, and they can make or break the dreams of these two players.
Three wood again, you can go too far with a drive here. Drive to the top of the escarpment. Get the towel out. Sweaty palms.
Nail down that.
Still, this course is soft, the way that dug its toes in.
All the signs of being under pressure, a dry throat, damp hands, Maggot with the driver. Driven the ball beautifully all day. That's a touchdown the left, I think. And then it's too far left and stays in the second cut of rough. And I don't think he can reach it from there. Well, all great championship courses always have a sting in the tail, and Congressional is no different.
No, it isn't. And 480 yards, you see, it's a lot for a par four, but it is downhill very sharply, and ever more downhill the closer to the green you get. Then, of course, you've got a green, and it's the shape of the green. It gets narrower the more it digs out into the lake. I bet it's more into the lake, perhaps, than that graphic shows, and those bunkers on the right, and more important, the ones behind the green on the right-hand side, there to protect the ball perhaps from going into the water if it goes into the green short right.
Let's hear what Colin Montgomery thinks of this one.
17, 480, par 4. You need your driver. And I've been hitting two or three good drives down there and leaving myself with a 7-iron to the front of the green, 7-6-iron to the front of the green, and 4-iron, 5-iron to the back. And we've come to the conclusion that if I'm one behind and five ahead of third place, we go for it on Sunday, because you know where the pin's going to be Sunday. It's out on that lake. And that's the only time I think we'll be going for that particular pin. It's just too dangerous.
Ernie Els has played this in 4-5-3, Colin Montgomery in 5-5-5.
And that's how it's playing today, and perhaps not surprisingly, the third toughest hole on the course, after number 6 and number 10. And as Colin quite correctly surmised, the pin in the back, it's a little saucer at the back of the green, and even if you do find the front larger right-hand side, it is a very, very difficult two-putt. Big ridge between the front of the green and where the pin is cut. Here's the graphic, and that's a fairly accurate display. A big swing from right to left as well if you're putting from the front. And of course, as you're coming in, it looks such a small target as you come in from up above the hole, and that bit of the green at the back looks tiny and narrow, surrounded as it is by water. I'll tell you what, it's a brilliant hole at this particular moment.
Colin clenching his teeth, and well, all our hearts go out to him. He's carried the British flag over here for the last 5 years. He's come so close, and only 17 and 18 stand between him winning this, and well, maybe Tom Lehman and Ernie Els will have something to say about it as well. Yeah, Maggot at the 16th and 193 from here. Bruce, and out with the fairway wood.
Yes, that may surprise a few people, and I think it's certainly a gamble on his part, but it's the one sort of club, and it's quite a shallow headed one, that you can actually get through this long grass, and it might just work. But I think the rough is too tough, too long, too standing, too straight up for it to be successful.
A last throw of the dice perhaps. He's got it airborne, but it started right, and that's over the green on the right side, and Maggot's hopes of taking this championship have gone.
Yeah.
yards for Lehman. As Montgomery belts his tee shot with a 3-wood down the 17th. That is a corker.
Might even be enjoying it. Now, Lehman. iron in his hand. Shouting up there. His work cut out. Poor shot, it must be said.
Poor club selection, I think.
Yeah.
A long, long way for a 7-iron, 189 yards. But again, mindful of not going past the flag. There's the drive with the legs. Connection was fine. I think looking to be something like 15 or 20 feet short of the hole. And he would have been had he been 2 or 3 yards left.
Take it out!
Just drifting fractionally down the left-hand side, but I think that would be an ideal position.
Else first and possibly a bit of match play coming in, but I think this is the most frightening shot on the entire golf course, not just the fact that it's at 17, but what do you do? And as Montgomery told us, there's no way he will be trying to reach the back portion of this green.
Montgomery has kept his composure and his calmness all the way through this last round. He's just two holes away from the end, but you know, I have a feeling this has got playoff written all over it. Three holes from home, we're on the 16th here at Congressional, and Jeff Maggott missed the green off long to the right, and Tom Lemon on that grassy bank by the bunker. Really bad lie, it sunk right down to the roots of that long grass. There's been a bit of a delay here, Maggott had to get a ruling. Last thing you need is to be hanging around there. So many thoughts going through the mind as it races with the adrenaline flow.
There's confirmation of what you were saying, the caddy having to stay over and keep an eye on the ball because it would be so easy to come back and having not able to find a tread on it. Played, but you remember Colin Montgomery's putt, the almost sideways job, so the chances of holding that are slim.
What a sight this is. 213 yards, you've got to decide, are you going to take the flag on? Most sensible people would play for the heart of the green. L's out with the 5-iron, which suggests he is certainly going to go at least halfway up the putting surface. Setting up for the draw. This is world-class plus.
It certainly is. He's thrown it all the way over the ridge and left himself a 15-footer. Had the courage of his convictions. Cracking shot.
Not for nothing has he won the world match play for the last 3 years. Back to Maggott. Very, very well played from there. Free drop, remember, but it was a free drop. And he'll have that to stay at 3-under. What does Montgomery do now?
He's 10 yards here, 203, 6-iron. And he's spun out of this one. It needs to come down quickly.
Come down. Come down.
Yeah.
He took 5 here at 7 o'clock this morning and Els made 3. How he gets down in 2 from there, I'm not so sure.
Yeah!
once more. The two ahead are the ones who share the lead, at least for the moment.
Monty marching down the 17th to rapturous applause. Else acknowledging that. Well, there's still quite a long way to go. Many things can happen, but you cast your mind back to the 10th hole when Else chipped in from the front of the green, having Andy Clapp. And that might just be the turning point.
To two, and that's it. Maggot and Lehman will have heard the roar that greeted Else's second shot, an absolute stunner. He's hung in there well, but three putts at 13 really did for him.
Is going to be his. He has to dig deep and somehow manage a birdie at 17 and 18. To 17 we go now.
Now Montgomery's found a reasonably decent lie here. He was sitting pretty well, sort of sparse area of grass he's lying in. He's just trying for the hard drawn 6-iron and just came out of it a fraction, so easily done to get frightened of missing it on the left. Obviously 5 yards left of the green is the water. All is not lost yet by any stretch of the imagination. He's got a little ridge to come over and it's downhill and it rather gathers to the hole. Big swing from right to left. You can hear it's rather a lot of excitement going on around here. There's a huge gallery and an electric atmosphere. Well, no Scotsman has won the US Open for 70 years.
The pin will be on the back.
I think Montgomery has to get down in two from here if he's going to win it outright anyway, that's for certain.
The marshals will have to get in amongst the crowd there and calm them down, and Montgomery doing the right thing. Just needs to forget all the things that are going on around him and keep focused on the job in hand. And the 17th owes him something. It's cost him three shots so far this week.
About 8 or 9 feet of fringe to carry, then the ball, when it lands on the green, will just release a little bit to the left.
Quite sensational this afternoon. Well, they're still back up on the hill.
Well, they have their problems back on the tee. Just a few yards away from the television village when all these pictures are being transmitted. all over the world. Massive television audience watching this. Just look at the gallery down the right side. They're lining the fairway, giving the shape to the hole.
Bit down the hill, a fraction from left to right.
Get the hole!
That's not dead either. Montgomery will putt first.
For Lehman, and he draws the ball, and that's the perfect shape for this tee shot. That should do nicely.
Montgomery waiting because the 18th green is very adjacent, it's just separated by water. Jay Haas putting there. Had a good run at this championship, Haas, but that all came to an end at 17, where he double bogeyed and took six, now at plus two. Well, he's been holding these putts beautifully all week. Montgomery is another at 17, but not before Tommy Tools putts for his birdie two at the last. Bogeys at 16 and 17 have taken him out of the race. Started the day at level par, and he'll have that tap in at the last for a round of 72.
Well, it's exciting. The effort of this great bank, and everybody can see the last two holes, but it's a terrible time to have to wait.
Jay Haas still has a tap in, so Montgomery will have another minute or two before he strikes his putt. A good week for Tommy Tools and for Jay Haas, but their efforts come up just a little short. You feel for Colin Montgomery out there. All the noise by the people in the bank on the left of your screen. There's not that many people behind the 18th. There's not much room there. And this would test the mental ability of any player in the world.
We're waiting for everyone to quieten down. See Alistair McLean signalling to that gallery over there. Just a fraction from the right. Now, come on, Colin.
He's pushed it. And that's the fourth consecutive five at the 17th for Monty this week. But all is not lost. He took five this morning and came back to birdie the 18th, and that's what he needs to do now. Just just bubbled over a couple of spike marks there. Oh, oh, so close.
Two and a half feet for Else, but he was well up to it. And he now leads. At one point there were four and four under, the others have fallen away. And if he can make a three at the last, either Montgomery or Lehman are going to require a birdie.
The only player in US Open history to be tied in birdie the final hole to win by one. Well, you have to go back to 1926. It was Bobby Jones. That's the line he needs to carry the ball on. '94 NBC thing. Almost on the pin at the 18th and let it turn over from right to left. Penultimate hole, and the championship is in the hands of the South African Ernie Else. Dear, oh dear, oh dear. I don't think he pulled it, I think he caught it heavy on the downslope. Easy thing to do. But he'll be playing four. And one would think the best he can manage is a five. As soon as he hit it, he cried no. Lehman's hopes sunk without trace at 17.
Left is Armageddon, but only right of the pin. That's a very sensible shot. Two putts from there should be, if not a formality, a distinct probability.
Montgomery's got a choice to make now, and I think he has to go straight at it.
Not the easiest of pins for Montgomery to get at, 185 yards down the hill.
Quiet, please.
There's a good bit downhill. Montgomery's going with a hard 7-iron. He's just coming out of that one, the 7-iron.
Well, he's given himself a chance. Dramatic scenes at the Congressional Country Club. We're coming to the closing stages of the 97th US Open, and the championship is definitely in the hands of Ernie Els. Two putts, and one would think that will be good enough. tumultuous welcome for Colin Montgomery and Ernie Els as they approach the last green here at Congressional. And shortly, maybe moments away from being at the end of one unbelievable week. Latter water hazard at the 17th. Layman's ball hit the land first. Now he'll place it there. And of course, he can chip that in, make a four. On a two at the last, who knows? Els has got a difficult two. Putt Montgomery's got a chance. It's going to go all the way.
But quite probably it'll be Maggot to go first. But meanwhile, the putting on 18 has more relevance. Els first. It's got to go up a dip, down the other side, and up again. Judgment of pace, not easy. And the great thing Montgomery did there, he got his tee shot inside Els. If Els knocks this to the hole side, he'll know that he might as well have a run at the putt because he's got nothing to lose. He wants the title. Second doesn't really interest him. The other side, but about the same length that Montgomery left his himself. And I think they're now going to wait while the chipping and the putting is concluded over here. Ages, you don't know.
Through the break, it's a good shot from an awkward position, but not good enough.
Now, I think the two on 17 should stand aside and wait for 18 to hole up.
To the swell. It's quite strong on pace, and well, that's an awkward distance left for Ernie Els. He gave it a good run at the hole, all of 4.5 feet, maybe 5. Dejection of giving so much and then it all falling apart at the very last moment. Sad scenes for Jeff Maggot.
Come on. Steady. Beautiful putt. It was a very complex line to select. It's guaranteed a three, and now all he can do is wait.
Down, guy. Founder. Founder. Get down.
Back at 17, Lehman for his five. Which he bravely gets, but he's back to minus two. Two shots behind Ernie Els, one behind Colin Montgomery. And unless Lehman can hold his tee shot at the 18th, Els will have this for the championship. Beautifully done, and Els turns to the gallery, and he knows it's unlikely that Lehman's going to get a one, and he will join that elite band of players to win the US Open twice in the same decade. Willie Anderson, John McDermott, Walter Hagen, Bobby Jones, Goodell, Hogan, Nicklaus and Strange, and it's a great effort from Colin Montgomery. He did everything that was asked of him, but he's come up just short again. His performance over the week has been quite excellent, and he can go back with his head held high. But a brilliant final round performance from Els. You look at the 10th when he chipped in, the second shot at 17 was quite sensational. Courage beyond the call of duty, and these are very happy scenes on Congressional's 18th green. A big smile over his caddy Ricky Roberts. Els finishes at 4 under and 276 looks to be the mark.
Well, Colin Montgomery did everything. He said he was going to do a 69 and a 6, and there's Ernie's girlfriend?
Liesl, and his mum and dad there as well, and there's a few tears in their eyes. Liesl's been his greatest supporter. But of course it's not over, because back on the tee, if Lehman can find help from somewhere to knock this ball in the hole, then we will have a playoff. There's four holes in one already. We've had a couple here at Congressional this week, but that was before the championship started. Scott Dunlap had one of these, and here at the 18th, Mark Calcavecchia pulled a four iron when the wind was in the player's face. Strange how these final two holes have just separated the field.
It always looked like it would. Well, they would. 7 iron for Lehman, same as Els Montgomery. At least it's not in the water.
Ernie Els is the new US Open champion. Well, your thoughts go out to Colin Montgomery. And one has to say he lost it in the second round.
He did. It's always hard to look back. Maggot drives.
should be okay for fourth place. Colin Montgomery said he wanted a 69, he'd settle for it. He's done that, but in the end, it was one shot shy.
The happy scenes at the back of the 18th green. A kiss for Liesl, a hug for Mum, and look at the smile on his dad's face. What a championship we've had, and we've seen it all live on Sky Sports. Ernie Els has just finished on the 18th green here at Congressional. He's won the US Open Championship, and the celebrations begin. Commiserations for Monty once again. He'll be back for more. He loves this type of golf. And Els has been away, I think, for too long. The agony for Colin, but we should all be very, very proud of him.
I agree 100%. And there's no disgrace in losing today. He lost to a man who was inspired for him. He's played really, really well. He didn't lose it, the other man won it. He'll be for concentrating on the 17th, but there was an awful lot of good play in there.
Lehman's little chip off the 18th, and it's a gorgeous shot. His undoing was the second to the 16th. Emo and Colin, his time will come. He's too good not to get his name up there. His manager there, Guy Kinnings. He has a great team behind him. And with the quality of golf he's displayed here, I wouldn't bet against him at Royal Troon. This man holds that title. And it's all gone very quiet.
Went cold. Four shots went in the last four holes, but he was there for most of the final round. No, he's got to hold that, otherwise he's in a great clutch of players at plus two. The 74 in the end for Maggot. His contribution was greater than that, and he'll be very disappointed.
Many losers, but there's more championships in front of them. Well, that's the way it all finished. 2-7-6 was the mark, and Ernie Els champion by one from Colin Montgomery. Tom Lehman on his own in third place, and these are the only players that finished under par on this demanding blue course. Maggot hung on for fourth place despite that three putt at 17 and 18. And a good championship for Bob Tway, who didn't know he was playing until Tuesday. Olin Brown, he'll gain an awful lot of confidence from his performance this week. And with Jim Furyk, they finished at plus two, alongside Tommy Tolles and Jay Haas. Scott McCarron, who won in Georgia last month, three under par with Scott Hoke and David Ogren. And Stuart Sink, just 24 years of age, off the Nike Tour last year, finishes at plus four with Lauren Roberts. Billy Andre joined them. Three players on plus five. One of them, Jose Maria Olazabal. And that 16th tie finish is good enough to hoist him up to 10th in the Ryder Cup standings. Nicky Price at plus six. And what a great championship for Lee Westwood. He ties with Nicky and Tiger Woods. Stankowski and Sutton, who challenged on day three, plus six for them. Scott Dunlap, who had a great start to the week, finishes on plus seven with Steve Elkington. Paul Goydas had a good run today. 2.88 he finished. Former champion Payne Stewart at plus eight, and Mark McNulty, who was in such great position when we had the rains of day two, also on 2.88. Fuzzy Zeller, Hideki Kase, Kelly Gibson, and Jeff Sluman. Nine over par for last week's winner at the Kemper, Justin Leonard. Grant Waite from New Zealand also on that total. 66 for Steve Stricker on day one. He couldn't keep it up. 289 with O'Meara, Cook, Nobolo, and Appleby.
Well, I'm sure all of you would convey your thanks to Ewan and Bruce and Ken for a marvellous performance and the commentary this week. They've been on for some 35 hours and there's absolute bedlam around Butch and me at the moment here. Any else has just come out. Colin Montgomery, who had gone away for a quiet moment with his wife to compose himself, has come back to face what you might be call the music, all the press and media around here. And in these situations, Butch, it's always a balance between the winner and the loser. And the start of this week, if somebody said pick a winner between two guys, it would be difficult. You would think so much of both of them.
Oh, there's no doubt about it. They're two both great players. I feel for Colin Montgomery. He had putted beautifully all day long. It came down to one putt on 17 and it didn't go in. Ernie Els, I can't say enough about him. I think that Ernie Els may have won this tournament this morning when he got to come back and play 15, 16, and 17 on freshly mowed greens in dry conditions and made three birdies in a row, and that's what got him back into this tournament. He then played beautifully today, shot 69, wins the tournament by one shot. He hit a marvelous shot at 17, I might add. I don't think anyone could ever imagine how difficult that golf shot is that he hit at 17. No one was shooting at that pin all day long, and he knocked it right over the top of it. My hat's off to Ernie Els. He's a great champion. It's his second United States Open Championship, and he's very deserving.
He's moving into the greats because not too many players at his age, 27, having won two U.S. Opens in such a short space of time.
Well, and he's a fine man. I mean, Ernie Els is a quiet, big man that goes about his business. He's like a big teddy bear. He's fun to talk to. He's fun to be with. He has the swing we all love to watch with the beautiful rhythm and tempo. And now he's won two majors, and there's many, many more out there waiting for him.
I think undoubtedly the shot at 17 that Butch was referring to is
a remarkable shot. I mean, this is about 200 yards down the hill. If you look at where that pin is, it's just stuck out in the back of that peninsula, that green, and this ball carried right over the top of the flag. Just a marvelous shot. The guts to even play that shot is incredible.
The moments on 18 when it was won for Ernie, despite the fact that Tom Lehman still had an ace for a playoff, his emotion when he put his hand in Colin Montgomery, he knew what Colin Montgomery was going through, and it was nice to see.
These are all great champions. They've all, you know, when you think of a golf tournament, it's a very cruel thing. We had 156 players start this week, and we had one winner. That means there's 155 losers. Ernie knew exactly what Colin was going through, and he felt for him in his own way. But not to take anything away from Ernie Els. I mean, it's just fantastic. There we see him going down to the presentation. He's been there before.
He's been there before. Judy Bell there of the USGA with him at Oakmont in 94. She was one of the committee of the USGA. Now she's been elevated to greater ranks, and she's there. Dan Hicks on the right of NBC. We're going to see an official presentation of that famous old trophy. His name is already on that trophy. You can never forget the shots under the old oak tree at Oakmont. Now he's on that semi-island green at Congressional, and he's about to talk to Dan Hicks.
Wasting it again. again for the second time in 4 years at age 27?
Well, to be honest, no. I really worked hard for this one. Game's been a little off at the beginning of the year and missed the cut. I believe in myself, believe in my golf game. I want to thank the Lord. I mean, I tell you, I prayed out there today. My grandfather back home, you know, I spoke to him just before I played today, and I knew I was going to be okay after I spoke to him. And I want to tell everybody back home in South Africa, Leopard Creek, Fancourt, everywhere, hi, thank you.
Ernie, it was an incredible four-way shootout out there. The emotions running high, running low. You had to survive it. Give us a sense of what it was like out there on the golf course, especially in the back nine when four had a chance to win it.
It was quite unbelievable, I'll tell you. Winning US Opens doesn't come easy, I can tell you that. Some great competition out there today. Tom Lehman, Jeff Maggot, and my playing partner today, Colin Montgomery. He's such a great player. It was tough. I knew I had to hit good golf shots. The only shot I didn't hit all that well was probably one on 13, where I just hit it through the green. But you know, I'm unbelievably delighted. Yeah, the shot that really won it for me probably was on 17.
What about the shot on 10? That was an important chip in. That had to be one of the keys out there as well.
Definitely. You know, I came up short for my second shot. I just wanted to keep it out of the water on the right. And I had a really great lie there in the fairway, and I felt good about the chip. You know, I played that shot in practice rounds, and I was feeling good about it, and it worked out.
Well, we're going to take a look at it right now. Again, one of those things that has to happen. You need to get a little bit lucky to get those kind of shots to win an open, but you were bearing down on it pretty good.
Yeah, I really had it going on 7 and 8. I had a pitching wedge in my hand on 9 for my third shot, and I just got a little too cute with that shot and made bogey there. But I just tried to hang in there. You know, I know, you know, US Opens, you know, you just got to try and make pars. And you know, I was 4-under through 10, and you know, I thought that was going to be the number, funny enough, and you know, it was. You know, coming down the stretch, you know, it just gets tougher and tougher. You know, they hit the fairways, and if you miss a fairway, you're just chipping out. And you know, as I say, on 17 was probably the shot of the tournament for me.
Well, congratulations, Ernie Els from South Africa, the Open champion here for the second time in 4 years. Let's go over to Roger Maltby. Roger.
Thank you, Gavin. So the champion, and such a great champion, Rich Harriman. We came here this week anticipating a wonderful US Open Championship, because everyone who was coming into it, including your own pupil Tiger Woods, seemed to be on form for it, and I think it's been delivered.
Oh, I think it's wonderful. I think, you know, they say the first hurdle is to win a major championship, and then they say you're not a great player until you win another one. Well, Ernie's proved he's a great player.
And you know, for all the other players who've come here this week and been disappointed, they can be inspired by this young Ernie Els, who, of course, in the last couple of years hasn't enjoyed the best of fortunes.
No, I think he's been up and down. Even this year, he hasn't played that well. He hasn't had any real big tournaments or big wins. I think this is something to come here on a course like this that's so hard, that's so demanding off the tee, and prove that he played better than anyone else. I think this is going to make Ernie Els a little hard to beat the rest of the year, too.
Well, Butch, thanks for being with us. It's been a pleasure, and obviously it's been great to see Tiger this week. We wish him well for the rest of the year, and you. And from everyone in the Sky Sports team, we came here, we were talking about Greg Norman, Tiger Woods, Nick Faldo, Ernie Els, Colin Montgomery, Fred Couples, all kinds of superstars. In the end, it came down to one man, Ernie Els. He's your champion, the 1997 U.S. Open champion, from all of us here at Congressional. Bye-bye.
Sky Sports with